Hello everyone, Bicycle Walrus here. Just wanted to let you guys know that this is actually only part one of this question and answer series. Basically, we only actually filmed part one today. We're going to be live streaming again tomorrow, Tuesday, at the exact same time, exact same place. We're going to finish up the rest of our questions with Jeromy Walsh then, and we can't wait to have you. And it's going to be an awful lot of fun, just like this question and answer session was. So without further ado, guys, enjoy the show. Thank you. Welcome to DM21 Gaming. My name is Bicycle Walrus, and today we are bringing to you a very special stream. Joining me today is Jeromy Walsh, otherwise known as Caspian, the technical director and CEO of Soulbound Studios. And wow, I'm so happy to have him. Caspian, sir, how are you?
I am doing very well. Thank you for having me on the show. This is a show, right? Do we call this a show or a stream?
We could call this a show.
Okay, let's go show. Well, thank you very much for having me on your show.
Well, thank you for being here. It's quite an honor, and I know we have quite a... we got a ton of questions to go through, so I'm just going to hop right on into it, if that's all right with you.
That sounds good.
All right, fantastic. So, real quick, guys, to go ahead and provide some background here, we're going to be discussing a number of concerns and questions that people have about certain game mechanics that, you know, they maybe have a bit of worry about. This is more or less a constructive criticism type bit of questioning as opposed to a, oh my gosh, you know, the sky is falling, we're concerned. We're obviously still very early in the development process of the game, and so that's kind of where we're at. So, the first couple of questions are about talents. And so Lankic says that, you know, I'm a very selfish person. And I, you know, I worry that I won't get a talent. And Wyke also asks a bit of an associated question, which is, I want to be a magic user. I've paid my money, so make it so that I can be a magic user. Fix this now! How would you respond to that?
Those are good questions. They're very closely related, and it was something that I thought about before we did the first design journal. I had this question of whether or not I wanted to talk about magic at all from the very beginning, or whether or not I wanted to delay and wait until later. Ultimately, we went ahead and talked about talents early on because we felt like kind of showing our cards early and talking about the features of a soul was the right thing to do. But in retrospect, I kind of wish that we had left that out at that point and had really just approached this game as this is an MMO that's it's sword and sorcery style, but magic doesn't exist in this world. It hasn't been seen in thousands of years, and just kind of leave it at that. A lot of people have made a comparison to our game and some other like animes like Sword Art Online and Log Horizon. And, you know, in Sword Art, they've got this concept of sword arts, but there isn't actually magic in the world, at least not that's seen. And that doesn't happen until later in the show. And while there's really no connection between us and either of those shows, as I was watching that based on other people's recommendation, you know, it struck true. It's like, yeah, this is a combat-based world. It's a world of survival. It's a world where there are important things on the line. And magic doesn't really play a role in this. It doesn't really exist. And so that's kind of the message that we want to deliver with this world is that if you see people doing magic, it should be feared and it should be dealt with accordingly. And you're not going to see people wandering around doing magic. You're not going to have a mage in each of your parties. That's not going to be a big influence on the game. And so if I could, I would go back and I would actually reset history and say, listen, there's no magic in this game. And then when it happens and people see magic and it's, you know, something that's going on around them and it becomes part of the story, then everybody kind of wondering, well, what do we do now? Like, how do we deal with this? Is this a character mechanic? Is there some way for us to get this? Like, what do we do? And unfortunately, people kind of know in advance that's kind of going to happen. The best thing I can tell people at this point is it's going to be extremely rare to the point where it's almost non-existent. And so we still hope that people won't feel like the fact that some small percentage of people out there can get it and everybody can't, other than that, is going to be a game changer for them. The other thing I can tell you, and this is kind of a foreshadowing, if you will, is that the magic and the existence of magic and kind of how prevalent it is a main part of the storyline. And I'm not saying that magic will ever become commonplace. That would certainly go against what we're trying to achieve in the world. What I can say is that we have intentionally withheld enough about the magic system so that you guys don't have a clear picture yet about how magic works, how common it is, or whether it's something you would even want if you could. So at this point, I'd say just don't worry about it. Wait until we are able to tell you a little bit more about how the magic system works, and you might find that that's less of an issue for you.
So essentially, what you're saying here is that, hey, you know, this is a world of combat, and magic is one of those really unknown things that people in this world don't even really know exists. So if everyone could all of a sudden say, I want to be a mage, which is what Wyke is saying, I've paid money, so let me be a magic user. Well, what you're saying is, your argument is, well, no one's a magic user, except all of a sudden, maybe one day, this happens, and we're kind of foreshadowing to that, but the way that you should look at it is, well, no one has magic, correct?
Yeah, I think the way I would respond to that question directly is you actually did pay money, but you paid money to be a champion, an explorer, a producer, a gatherer. You paid money for the experience and to be a part of the story, and if it turns out that your particular character has magic, that should be looked at as icing. It's not actually what you paid for. That comes separate.
Okay, fantastic. And this kind of leads into our next question, which is from Prime. And Prime says, I'm afraid that most people with talents or story souls will never know, so the 5% will look like 0%. And I'm actually going to add on to this question a little bit, too. It's 5% of souls, not 5% of players, correct?
It is 5% of souls, correct.
And so what that means is that when I buy the game, I get 3 souls, and so... Mm-hmm. I might not even play all 3 of those souls. I might only play 1. And there will be some souls that people would play that could have had talents, but they didn't play them. Is that also a potential?
That is also a potential, yes.
All right, cool. Well, I'll let you respond to the question. I was just trying to elaborate a little bit more on top of it.
Sure. Let's see the best way to... So in case you guys can't tell, I just had time to get the list of questions kind of written down and transferred over to a document, which was then immediately handed off to Bicycle Walrus. So I haven't had a chance to read over most of these. So if you were concerned that I'd have these answers prepared ahead of time and it would somehow seem artificial, well, you can clearly see that's not the case. 5% look like 0. So this question was brought up once before, and we kind of addressed it on the forums previously, but I wanted to take this opportunity to go ahead and answer it as well. For us, the concept of talents are really there not as character building tools, they're story building tools. And that speaks to the previous conversation we had as well, which is people are thinking about the ability to have a talent as a character building mechanic. It makes them stronger somehow. Oftentimes the talents aren't gonna make you stronger, it's gonna make you a target. So it's not really something that you want. But with that said, we want these to be a tool for story building. And so one of the ways we've done this is just kind of randomly distributed these, because we know that eventually their use is going to play a role that will cause a story to happen. It's kind of the organic story. It's not contrived. It's just something that happens to some person. They're not prepared for it, and it leads to an interesting personal story for them. With that being said, we do have this concept of an overall, you know, 10-year story. And for those scenarios, we will find places where we want there to be talents in play. It's imperative that a talent exists in order for the story to make sense in a specific role. And in those cases, whether or not the person had a talent otherwise or not, it's entirely likely that we'll take the person who's closest to the storyline, who's in the best situation in order to make that story come true, and we'll give them the talent that they need in order for that to happen. And so they'll never know, obviously, whether or not they had the talent to begin with and it just had never been unlocked prior to that, or whether or not it was kind of gifted to them as part of the story. Ultimately, it's the same. It means that out of nowhere, completely unexpected, they have an opportunity to play a kind of a dynamic character role in the story. They have the opportunity to steer it one way or the other, you know, for good or for evil. And that the others around them who don't have those talents will have an opportunity to choose whether or not to follow them, to leverage the fact that they have those talents and support them, or to oppose them. And a lot of times that'll also depend upon the choice the person with the talent makes, whether or not they're supportive of the objective of everyone else or if they're not. So if you have a talent and you decide to use it for evil, those of you around you who might be on the darker path, they might choose to flock to you and support you. Whereas those who are opposed to you because they follow the light, that are obviously going to make you enemy number one.
Okay, you know, you touched on something that I have never heard of before, so I'm going to go ahead and reiterate it because, you know, you're answering these questions very fast. You said that the Soulborn engine will kind of be smart enough that if there's a person or a player who's kind of getting ready to go down the path that might be associated with this magic use. The engine might say, well, hey, this person's best positioned to take advantage of the story arc. Even though the soul did not actually have the talent at the beginning, he will now have the talent because he's actually progressing through that particular story. Is that correct?
That is correct.
So that actually, I think, eases a lot of concern in my mind, because me as a player, you know, my thought is, well, how can I go out there and make the most of my subscription? How can I go out there and make the most of this life and do something that's interesting or different, or I'm exploring and I come across a particular story arc that all of a sudden takes me down that particular path or that road? It's something that players can actively seek and search for if they desperately want a talent, knowing that eventually it would be possible for one to be assigned to them, correct?
Yeah, that's a good way to look at it. I think the best way to answer that is to say that we want to reward people for being heroic. That was kind of our goal from the outset, is we want to reward people for creating story. And while we do seed the world with these talents as a way to kind of create unexpected story, those who pursue it, those who put themselves in the path of being legendary heroes, they're going to find that they're statistically more likely to encounter those types of talents. And it's not because we're actually trying to reward people directly. Like, if you go out and you kill a demon, then we will give you a talent. It's more like I'm going to go out and kill a demon because I feel like it's something that my character should do. And you get close to doing it, but you know, you're going to fail on your own. And so the engine recognizes that you're playing a pivotal role. You're a catalyst for a larger story. And so it uses that opportunity to give you that talent. So I don't want to encourage people to go out and do heroic things because they feel like the Soulborn engine will save them and that it will give them the talent at the last minute. But it's true that going out and doing those types of heroic things and becoming an active part of the story will end up giving you a talent more often than not. And by not, I mean not more often than not doing it. I mean, if you weren't planning on having a talent, or if the engine wasn't going to give you a talent to begin with, if your character, when it was randomly created, didn't have a talent, your chances of getting one is much higher if you integrate yourself into the story than if you don't.
All right, knowing that we have limited time, I'm going to move on to the next question, though I'm dying to ask more about that particular subject. But we're talking about story, and Prime asks, well, how will players even know what their story is? I mean, it is random for every soul, and I haven't seen much on it. Can you elaborate on destinies and how the destiny will actually interact with the player's story?
Absolutely. So we talked about this in one of the previous design journals. It was like around design journal 3 or 4. And the Soulborn engine is a multi-layered system. And what I mean by that is that there are things happening at different levels. Animals, you know, are constantly, there's an ecosystem. And if you go out and kill, you know, a slew of animals, then it's going to break the ecosystem. And that's going to cause a chain of events, which will ultimately lead to some kind of scenario. There will be a story element there. I hate to say quest, because that word is overused, and it's something we try and avoid using in Chronicles of Elyria if we can. But think of it as a quest. You know, there will be a quest that will come as a result of the fact that there's an imbalance in the ecosystem. That's a result of player action, but it's not really tied into either the story engine or the destiny engine. It's a result of player actions. It's cause and effect. It's consequences for the things that they do in the world. But as a result of the things that they do, it gives them other things to do. And so that's one of the ways why we try and keep the players engaged. Then there is this concept of a personal story, and that's tied to your birth date. So from the moment your character is born into the world, they have a series of tasks that are going to be assigned to them. And again, it's randomly distributed based on your birth date. So without going too much into the astrology of it, you might find that for one reason or another, your character is destined to always oppose women. I'm using that as a random example because that was a conversation I was having with my wife recently. But because of this, your character just struggles with the opposite gender. We don't know why, it just does. And so as a result of that, you might find that as you travel from town to town, women whose NPCs, whose personality traits, which we use the big five personality model, we might find that women
referring
who are
to Ocean there, correct?
Correct. You might find that the women that you encounter, the NPCs that you encounter, who aren't open to you, based on the openness attribute, tend to give you a hard time. Maybe they send you to do tasks which are counterproductive. They just kind of troll you. And so your story is that you are constantly being trolled by the women in your life. And that's something that, you know, we didn't plan for necessarily. It's just kind of how the engine worked out based on the results that we came up with for your specific character. So it's not something that you have to look for. It's not something that you're going to have to try and hunt down for your story. It's just going to be your play experience. And you're going to know it because wherever you go, however you play, things are popping up which are presenting themselves as things for you to do, which are all based on your personal story. That's one layer. And I'm going to regret using that example about the versus women.
No, it reminds me. It reminds me of a fan fiction I once wrote for COE. Anyway,
so there you go. So, yeah, and that actually is what sparked that conversation. We can follow up on that offline. There's obviously the Destiny engine as well, and the Destiny engine is a higher level part of the story engine. So it's not just your birth date, but there is this overall 10-year story. And I like to compare it to a choose your own adventure book where there is lots of different choices at any one point in time. There isn't a single outcome. There might be a dozen possible outcomes. And we break the story up. You guys have never heard this before, but I'll say that we chose Chronicles of Elyria as opposed to World of Elyria or Elyria Online or, you know, any of the other names, because the concept of Chronicles to us speaks to us of text, of books, you know, of epic novels. And that's kind of what we wanted to recreate with this game, was this idea of you living out an epic story. And so we kind of had divided up this 10-year story into books, and each book is going to last about a year. So there's about 10 books in this story, and these books are further divided up into chapters. And the chapters for us could be months, for example. And what happens is that at the transition point, at the inflection between one chapter and another, we don't really know what the players are going to do and how they're going to come out of that chapter. But what we do know is that at any point in time, the engine is looking at how close you are to one of the possible outcomes, and it's trying to drive you to one of those outcomes. So it's introducing quests, it's creating conflict, it's creating NPCs that have certain personalities in order for them to grow up and cause conflict. It's driving the story towards one of those outcomes. But the choices that the players make might steer them towards one of the others. And as soon as they do, then it adds weight to that. It adds credibility to it, and it drives them to that other story outcome instead. And so the whole engine is built around this concept of triggers, things that players can do, and eventual outcomes. And it might be that they start heading in a direction that we didn't anticipate at all. And it has the potential to do something that's just cataclysmic or fantastic or awesome or whatever. And that's why we're not writing the whole story up front. We do have a plan to have an overall storyline, but we will have writers on staff so that as things kind of progress, we have the opportunity to respond to things as necessary. But again, this isn't something players need to look for. It's something that they're going to be involved in whether they know it or not.
Okay, real quick, I did kind of want to point at something real quick. You know, the story engine, I think one of the concerns that people might have if you bring it up is that, well, is it going to make me do something I really don't want to do? And I remember something from a design journal that was basically suggesting that the Soulborn engine takes into account your affinity. If you're light attuned or dark attuned. So this wouldn't really put anybody in a position to go against the type of character that they've developed or a persona that they develop for themselves, correct?
Correct. So it's important to call out that what's presented to the characters in general is not going to be a quest to go do something. What's presented to the characters is a conflict. It's a struggle. It's a problem. And how the player chooses to solve that problem is up to them. And then as their affinity guides them towards one way or the other, then the problems will be indicated. It will be clear what the intended outcome is, but the players still have an opportunity to either fulfill the requirement or to go opposite to it. But what we're really using, when I talked about the birth dates and the conflict and the things that are likely to happen to a player, I should have been very specific in saying that the conflicts that, for example, with the women, that, you know, wherever you go, you're always in conflict with women. You have an opportunity to choose how you resolve those conflicts. There might be multiple different ways to solve those conflicts, some on the light side, some on the dark side. So, yeah.
We're going to move on to the next story question, which is from Alyssa Imagine, or Alyssa Imagine. And her question is, I worry without raids, there won't be any really strong monsters that you need more than one person to defeat. What's your response to that?
So I was looking through this list of questions, and I chose to put that one in the story category as opposed to like the content category or something like that, to remind myself how to answer this question, which is, if you've read any of the lore by Inara Starsong, you already know there is belief that the ancients, these anti-Peruvians, have been awakened. And I wouldn't say there aren't going to be any really strong monsters in the world for you to defeat. I'll just leave it at that.
Oh, okay. We're going to move on to fantasy versus realism, which is a rather larger topic. It's one of our larger ones for tonight. Ender asks, I'm worried about the non-realistic elements. I don't like having sorcerers, dragons, vampires, and whatnot running around. Those are exactly the things that can unbalance the game. An overpowered sorcerer, a powerful vampire, an immortal army, etc. And so really what this is kind of getting to is game balance. You know, traditionally MMORPGs, everybody's balanced. Everybody is the same power level, maybe different roles, but otherwise they have the same power level. And so maybe that's kind of where his concern is coming from, is the traditional sense of MMORPGs.
So I also put the story section right below this fantasy versus realism to remind myself to flow from Alyssa Images, Imagine's question into this one, which she says, I worry without raids that there won't be any really strong monsters that, you know, you need to, that might require more than one person to defeat. And then immediately after that, Ender calls out that, you know, there are going to be these overpowered sorcerers, powerful vampires, immortal armies, and that sort of thing. And that those cause a problem with game balance. And actually, Ender's question is my solution to the previous question, which is that we have intentionally introduced the opportunity for players in the world to become overpowered, to become unbalanced, the ability to become a superpowered sorcerer, the ability to become, you know, the most powerful vampire, or the, you know, the head of an entire coven of vampires, or even, you know, the rumor of there being the ability to become a lich and having, you know, this immortal army, or, you know, necromancy, the ability to raise the dead. Those are not going to be things that are going to sit well with most players. And so the objective here is that when somebody does become the overpowered sorcerer or the powerful vampire, that everybody else who's looking for a raid boss now finds one. And so it's our intention that these unbalances create player content. That's kind of, it's by design.
Okay. That, you know, and you know, kind of thinking about that, it's... In a world where, obviously, permadeath is a thing, and you have these ultra-powerful players, you know, I can immediately see the concern that someone might have of is like, well, these ultra-powerful players are now taking not only my character's life into their hands, but my pocketbooks into their hands. And so, you know, and we know that the Soulborne engine is smart enough to distinguish the difference between a PC and an NPC. Is it smart enough to distinguish the difference between a PC with talents versus a PC without talents? And would the risk be lowered for trying to go after these guys?
I'm not sure I fully understand the question.
So basically, if I'm killed by a PC, I, you know, the Soulborne engine recognizes that, okay, he was killed by a PC, his spirit loss from spirit walking will be, you know, a certain amount. Mm-hmm. Now I'm killed by a PC with talents. So I decided to go after them, or they decided to grief me because they're overpowered. Because you're introducing an overpowered player who now can take my pocketbook and my experience into their hands. Is there a way to kind of balance out the penalties from being, I guess, murdered by these people?
Sure. So obviously there's a lot of areas in here where we're not going to know. Generally, anytime we approach a problem, we know, okay, there's a sweet spot here. There's going to be a place where things feel too overpowered, and that these overpowered players really become so overpowered, there's nothing anybody can do about it. And on the other end, there is these players who become overpowered so little that nobody really notices that they even exist, and that they have power, but it's useless by and large, and it's not creating the story that we want to. It's not creating conflict. Anytime we look at one of those and we know that there's dials that we need to tweak and figure it out, we kind of look to play test to solve those problems. We want to get players into the world in alpha and in beta and have these vampires and sorcerers running around so that we can really see what it takes for them to incite a revolt. You know, how powerful does a vampire have to be before the village rises up with pitchforks and attacks them? On the other hand, we want to find out, you know, if we make the vampire that powerful, what's the real cost to the community? As it stands now, There's no checks and balances in place because it's pretty early on. But again, we want the powerful vampires and the overpowered sorcerers to make people want to attack them. And if they're this super powerful vampire that's living quietly in their castle on the edge of the village, not really doing anything, then we're kind of failing from story writer perspective, because we've introduced something that should cause story that's not. And so we need to make them overpowered enough so that it creates the opportunity for story.
Got it. Okay. Moving on to the next question. Gunholio is basically asking, it's a very long question, but I'm going to kind of summarize it here.
Vampires sparkle?
Yes, vampires, do they sparkle? Are you drawing inspiration from Twilight for vampires?
No, vampires don't sparkle. We've mentioned before that you won't actually be able to tell easily whether or not somebody is a vampire. Because if you've got this very powerful vampire who's doing very bad things and everybody wants to rise up and find them, part of the story is detecting who it is. You know, it's a game of murder mystery. And so if they sparkled in the daylight, that would be a little bit easy. What I can say is that the next design journal, we talk a little bit about anonymity as part of our discussion on identities and disguises and reputation. And one of the things we talk about is how you could throw on a cloak. And when you throw on a cloak, even if you recognize someone previously, even if you know who they are by sight, and they do have that little name tag over their head because you've encountered them enough that you want to be able to spot them in a crowd. If somebody throws the cloak over their head, they're not going to be spottable out in daylight or even at night. You're not going to know who they are. And that same cloak can be used by vampires to allow them to move about between buildings during daytime. So you'll probably look suspicious at someone if it's middle of the day and they're walking around in a cloak. And if you're a sheriff or somebody who has the legal reason to do so, you might want to go up and have a conversation with them. But in general, vampires are very powerful. And they only get more powerful as time goes on. And they are strong. I'm looking at the conversation here. They are strong, fast, and they are powerful. So yeah, people who
do
become
they burn in daylight.
They do burn in daylight. There is a dot that hits them in daylight if they are disrobed or if their cloak is removed from them or if they are, you know, otherwise engage in combat. And they cannot use their abilities during the daytime where the dot starts as well. So we, as far as we know at this point, daylight and one other way are the only two ways to defeat a vampire.
Okay, real quick, for those who are uninitiated, dots means damage over time. So it's like you're poisoned in the daylight.
Oh, come on, I'm hoping the audience knows that.
Just in case. You never know who's listening.
You never know. That's true.
All right, well, I think we've gotten through about vampires enough. Let's move on to the next question, because I feel like this one's going to generate a lot of conversation. The game's focus on realism and not being a WoW clone, I really don't think that's the focus, it just happens to not be one, will lead to devs implementing some game mechanics that are simply not fun. Some of the mechanics sound nice in theory, but I'm fearing that they will not be enjoyable for some players when implemented.
I'm going to touch on a couple different parts of that. There is a focus on realism, but it's realism for a purpose. If you look at a game like Ark Survival Evolved, they have realism for the purpose of having realism. They want to create that realistic feeling. They want you out in the wild. They want you afraid. Like you're wandering around in a world with dinosaurs. So you want that heartbeat. You want that suspense. You need to make sure you're keeping track of a lot of different things at once.
I'll never forget the first time my wife and I were chased by a T-Rex in that game. Just saying.
Yeah, there was swearing. I'm sure there was in my house. There was much swearing, followed by it's big, but we'll forgo the first word. The realism for us is a means to an end, and I can't stress that enough. We've got a lot of realistic elements in here. We've got the need for food, we've got the need for water, we've got the need for sleep. But those are our means to an end. They're not the focus of the game, and we don't want them to be the foreground. We're working on systems to try and make them, you know, there and something you're aware of, but not overbearing. Like if you're in town, you know, the need to go into a tavern or something like that to socialize. This is an example of us using food in town as a means to an end. It's a way to get people to socialize and to congregate in a place other than in front of an auction house, which obviously is going to be less common with live auction houses anyways. But that being said, the real reason we have these realism mechanics is so that we give opportunities for dynamic story. You're out in the world, it's nighttime. At night, your fatigue goes down quicker than it does during day. So it's a good time to rest. You could rest in the day, obviously, but it's a good time to do it at night. That requires you pitch a tent or a campsite, and you want food and you want water and you need the things that you're going to do. We also give people the opportunity to play some card games and some dice games and some, you know, they can sing and do their bardic things while they're gathered around the campfire and tell stories and all that. But the real reason we do that is really so that you have to set up a tent and light a fire if you want cooked food. Anybody that's watched or read Lord of the Rings remembers the scene where the party is out in the middle of the plains, and they find, of course, the highest point they can find, and they light a fire in the middle of the night, which draws the attention of everybody around. And that's what we're trying to recreate is this scenario where you march, you know, all day and halfway through the night to a nearby, you know, county or duchy that you're trying to invade. There's a castle there that's got an ancient evil in it or whatever the specific scenario is. You get there, you realize it's the middle of the night, you're tired, you're within eyeshot of this, you know, ancient keep. Are you really going to pitch a tent in the middle of the wild at night and start a fire so that you can recoup that energy? Or are you going to choose instead to sleep in the dark, you know, in the cold, and risk, you know, anything around you that you can't see coming into your campsite? Or, you know, potentially not sleeping and engaging the ancient keep not fully rested the next day. So it's an opportunity for players to think about how they want to approach the scenario. And we just use these realism mechanics as a way to drive those.
No,
the reason go ahead.
Okay, so I think you touched on a lot of the fun parts about realism.
Yep.
What about the not so fun parts about realism? So you and I have both played Ark Survival Evolved, and you notice that as time goes on, you realize, okay, before I can go here and do this, I have to go here and do that. I have to gather up the food. I have to cook the food, put most of it away in the refrigerator. I'm going to have to jerky it now so that way it lasts a little longer. And now that I got all that done, now I got to craft all these arrows. I got to go do this. I got to go do that. And everything becomes a chore before you can actually start playing the game. And I think that's kind of a bane, if you will, to the realism, is that will this become a chore, or is it being designed in such a way where it will not?
It's being designed in such a way that it will not. Again, that goes back to the dials. We'll know once we get people in and playing it whether or not something becomes tiring after a month or a week or 2 months or whatever the time frame is. But also, the use of offline player characters to do a lot of the more mundane tasks, preparing the food and stuff like that, as well as having people whose careers are bakers and stuff like that, means that people who have a passion for those things, who are less likely to get bored by those things, can focus on those things. And those who don't really want to spend the time cooking meals and doing that sort of thing, they could just, you know, buy their rations from a nearby, you know, pub or tavern and take them with them on the way out on, you know, onto their journey. We really do want to make these realism mechanics fall sort of into the background. You know, it's kind of like, what was the analogy that I heard recently? It's one of those things where the better it is, the less you notice it. And if people are noticing it, then we need to reevaluate it, because we don't want that to become the focus of the game.
While at the same time, it is a survival game.
It is.
I mean, like, I feel like I had to bring that up only because I love the concept of this being a survival game so much. Starving to death, which has almost happened to me several times in Ark, I'll get rescued by somebody at the last second. I mean, literally, someone will pass me a steak and boom, I'm like, oh, thank goodness, you saved me. We're still going to have those moments when you're out in the wilderness, correct?
Yeah. So it's one of those things where we want it to become a background thing until it's not. You know, it should be a background thing to prepare food. It should be a background thing to sit and eat. You should want to sit and eat because it's a good time to socialize and do other things that you're more interested in doing. But if you don't do those things, if you fail to do it, if those background tasks become, you know, forgotten completely, then we do want those side effects, because there's story in those too. If you don't prepare enough food and you're out in the middle of the desert or water, then that's a story in itself. So.
Or you get raided by bandits and they take all your food.
Exactly. I'm actually waiting for that. I mean, I relish the day when somebody comes and robs me of my food and leaves me there, like, strapped to a wagon with nothing but my, you know, underbreeches. And they don't kill me. They're just like, all right, well, we're going to take your food and leave you, you know, in your underpants. That will be awesome. There will be many screenshots of that.
You're thinking along the same exact lines I'm thinking. All right, next question. So this is kind of on, you know, the opposite end of the spectrum. So we know the realism is a big focus in this game. Has to be. It's a survival game. But I know it's a huge, I'm getting into this question. So Justeric asks, the realism. I know it's a huge selling point as well, but I fear the lack of some of the traditional fantasy elements, the unfair nature, and the aging system will thin the herd dramatically and make for a hard game to maintain. So basically he's fearing that the lack of fantasy elements might actually be a bane to the game as well.
Possibly. The best answer I have for that is that there are sci-fi games that don't have fantasy elements, and there are obviously modern games that don't have fantasy elements, and then there are fantasy, high fantasy games that obviously do. I'm gonna come back to this analogy many times probably during this Q&A, but somebody raised this question recently, or there was a conversation. I don't remember who actually said this. And so if you watch this live stream, and you do, if this was you, then please remind me. But I was having a conversation with somebody recently, and they said that Chronicles of Elyria is like a good dark chocolate. And we kind of had that conversation more, and then I had that conversation with Kamiguan as well. And you know what? It actually rings really true to me, because my family, we're chocolate connoisseurs. Anytime we travel, we find the nearest chocolatier and or chocolate maker and make sure to partake. But we look at World of Warcraft as kind of like the Hershey's out there. You know, they came along, and you can even go back further, EverQuest and Ultima Online. I mean, they were shipping raw cocoa powder to people, and the people back then, they loved it, but it wasn't refined, it wasn't processed, and it wasn't really as easy to consume. And then you have WoW comes along, and they're effectively the Hershey's, and they find this perfect recipe that, you know, people just love to consume. It's rich, it's creamy, it's easy to digest, everybody loves it, they can consume it in bulk. And then there's been a slew of clones that have come along since then. You know, you've got your Mars and everybody else that's coming along and making effectively the same recipe, with some slight variations in it. Well, Chronicles of Elyria we view as kind of like a really nice dark chocolate that's being developed by a small, you know, chocolatier. It's, you know, it's bean to bar. We're the developers and publishers, so we're, you know, it's all natural. And we're developing, you know, some say a niche product. What we like to think of it as is we're developing kind of more of an artistic. We're developing something for a more mature palate. And so, you know, people who have been playing World of Warcraft, who've been eating that milk chocolate for the last 10 years, many of them are ready to move on to something else. And we want to be there for them, for when they, you know, take a look at it and realize that this is a different flavor. It's a more mature flavor. It's a little bit sharper. It's, you know, it's evolved. But at the same time, there are a lot of people who still don't like dark chocolate, even now that it's becoming, you know, more and more common. People are learning to appreciate that it's healthier and there's all these good benefits to dark chocolate. There are some people who still, because it's easy, it's cheap, it's, you know, it's accessible, they'll reach for the milk chocolate. So the reason I brought that up is that not only are we, in this case, a dark chocolate maker, a very specific, very refined chocolate, but we also add our own flavors to it. You know, we add the little sea salt caramel to the chocolate as well, and a little bit of mint here and there. And people who don't like those flavors aren't going to like the chocolate, no matter how good of a dark chocolate it is. It's just not the kind of flavor that they're looking for, and that's okay. And my answer to this, honestly, and I'll do the people over at Revival a solid and tell you guys that they're doing a game very similar to what we are in a lot of different ways. There are a lot of systems that are the exact opposite to what we're doing as well. But with that being said, I mean, their theme is a kind of a gothic, you know, it's a different world. It's a Lovecraftian kind of world. So if people, you know, they don't like the specific theme of the world we're going with, this is a sort of sword and sorcery style world with a touch of fantasy elements as well. If they want something different, then maybe there's just another game out there that's doing something similar to what we are that's better for them. You know, they have a different palette.
Real quick, because I love the analogy, but I think really at the heart of the question is, where on the low to high fantasy spectrum does Chronicles of Elyria fall?
It's somewhere in the middle. It's more on the high fantasy than people think. There are going to be fantastic creatures, so dragons are definitely a thing. For those who haven't seen me on Skype or whatever, my alias is Dragon Walsh. I had a period of time where I was just totally in love with dragons. I was sketching dragons. I was reading about dragons. I was researching dragon lore. I was reading dragon prints and, you know, anything that had a dragon I was interested in. Dragons of Pern and the Caffrey, everything. So there is no way I'm not going to make this dream game of mine and not have dragons. At the same time, you know, we've already talked about vampires and stuff. So, you know, very likely undead will be a thing. Whether or not people encounter those regularly, we'll see. One thing I do want to call out is that these mystical creatures, these more fantastical things, because of where we sit in the low fantasy to high fantasy thing, those things are going to be less common. But when you encounter them, they're going to be that much more impressive as a result of that. You know, if you come upon a skeleton in your traditional D&D game, it's kind of like, oh, all right, well, it's a skeleton. Let's kill it and move on. You know, if you come upon a skeleton in a game like this, it's like, holy crap. There's undead. This is not good. We've never faced an undead before. We don't know what the effects are. Can you actually kill them, or are they going to keep coming at us? Like, you know, we want those types of things where people are just, they're overwhelmed by the fact that they're seeing these things for the first time. So you will see those higher fantasy elements, but it's not going to be on the surface and it's not going to be common.
All right, I'm going to move on to community. I feel that Zanz's question is pretty much Pazoki's question.
Okay.
So we're going to go ahead and move on. So the next one is from Savvy Cat. She says, my greatest worry is that after spending a great deal of time with community members and forming friendships with them, that once the game launches, it has something that causes them not to want to play, or they get bored and move on. So she's afraid she's going to lose her friends.
I think it's a he, between you and I. I think it's a he. But I read that off the list of concerns. I put that on there because I can sympathize. World of Warcraft has held on for so long, largely because it's the place where everybody goes to spend time with the friends that they've already established. You know, they reached that critical mass where there was a lot of people in the community. And so it feels like home, it feels safe. And we've started to build up this community now where people are meeting in IRC, they're on the forums all the time. You know, now they're starting to play games together. And I think that's fantastic. I really encourage that. I think that having a community is what Morpegs are all about. You know, it's really about having a large community. And the more people that we can bring into that large community, the better that it will be. As a, you know, in response to us doing something that's going to cause people to not want to play, we sincerely hope that doesn't happen. And that's kind of one of the reasons why we're being as transparent as we are about this, is we want people to know the game that we're making from the very beginning so that they can decide whether it's something for them or not. And we also do want feedback from players. Mostly the game has been designed by me with some feedback here and there from some close friends of mine. And historically, I'm a software engineer. And while I've been a dungeon master and game master for a long time, some of these things we're going to have to play test in order to really get feedback on. And when that happens, you know, we will take the players' feedback seriously. With that said, and this was related to a conversation that we had recently on the forums, is that this is really our vision. It's our vision of what the dark chocolate should taste like. And because we get a large number of people who say, yeah, it's not really my flavor of dark chocolate, we're still going to be working on the recipe that we want to eat, not what the community wants to eat. But I encourage people, if you're concerned about it heading in a direction that you don't like, to make sure that you provide feedback. And beyond that, keep the community close, you know, and make it your community, make it your game, and make sure that more people join you. And other than that, I mean, I don't really have a lot of control on whether or not they decide to leave or not, but I certainly hope not. And we hope that by engaging you guys and letting you know that we're listening, myself and Sozu and Kamiguin and others, we got Persephone coming in tomorrow, a new hire. We hope that by engaging you guys and letting you know that we're listening, that it's not just the community and the developers, that we're all one community. And it just happens to be that the developers are a subset of the community, because we are really gamers that are making a game for gamers. And that includes you guys too.
All right. The next question is kind of going a different direction here about the community. And that is, there is one thing that worries me more and more these days, and that is the COE community itself. There's a couple different ways I feel like you can interpret that question, though. I mean, are we talking about in-game, out-of-game? How do people communicate with one another? I mean, to me, I feel like this question is more or less kind of about inside the game, because there's so many different ways that I feel like that you could be devious in this game than you could be in others.
I don't read that one about being in-game. I view that one as being out-of-game. And I think what the concern there is that, you know, we were 1,000 people in the community just 3 months ago, and now we're, you know, just on the border of 10,000 accounts in the community. And that naturally has an impact. Like the nature of the community is going to change as it gets larger. And I think what he's concerned about is that as people join the community, that the people who are there may not be as close, because it's more of a diluted community. And also that as we become more mainstream, as the community becomes larger, that it's going to bring in a different audience. It's going to be less the people who are really interested in the game and more just are kind of coming to check it out. They're more casual. Maybe they have negative feedback because they didn't spend the time digging into the forums to read out, you know, about what the game's really about. And so I think what he's just saying is that he's concerned that the mood of the community, or the, you know, the state of the community is shifting, maybe in a bad way. I've certainly noticed the impact of having a larger community, but I don't think it's necessarily a bad thing. I will say two things, then I'll move on. The first of which is that we intentionally didn't add search functionality to the forums. I know everybody that's listening to this now is silently throwing things at us. we keep getting feedback that we need to add search features to the forums, and we didn't do it intentionally. And the reason we didn't do it was because when we first launched the website, we knew there was only going to be 100, 200, 1,000 people. And what we were looking for from that 1,000 people was the group of people who were really passionate about the game, who we could look to be our GMs, we could look to be our moderators and our community managers, and the people who would go out there and sell the game to others for us. And so we made gathering information about the game difficult intentionally, because we wanted to pick out those people who were willing to put forth the effort to learn about the game. And so we've reached that point now. We know who they are. We've isolated, we've identified, and we're really pleased with the community, that I say the more dedicated community members that have come from that. And so now we're adding in the search functionality, and we've moved stuff over onto the wiki. And as the information becomes available to everyone and everybody kind of gets on the same page and they understand what the expectations is, then we expect the rest of the community to kind of fall in line with the community that's already there. But yeah, that's, I think, why we're seeing that is that there was some frustration from the larger community that recently joined, and that frustration was designed to be there for a smaller community. But honestly, we've just grown faster than we expected to. So now we have to kind of change strategies.
All right. So now we're at a tipping point here, Caspian. We have 15 minutes left until the end of the hour, and we're nowhere close. So the question I have for you is, are you willing to go over, or should we skip to the questions that you're most interested in?
Well, I mean, I don't have a time frame. So this is that dangerous point where we can just make it a long stream and people can hear all about the cool stuff that we've got and the answers to these questions, or we can kind of cut it in two, or...
Well, I'll tell you what we can do, and we can ask them, but I already know their answer, and it's going to be go on. So if you have the time, I certainly have the time. So I just wanted to make sure, because I tried asking you one-sentence answer questions, and they turned into paragraphs. And books.
I'll be brief. I'll make an effort to move on more quickly. I will keep an eye on the watch now, and we'll move as quickly as we can.
Okay.
But let's drive onward.
Fantastic. Going on to weathers and seasons. Victoria Rachel asks, the developers have stated in the live chat that the seasons will be 25 hours long, and therefore the time seasons change is ever moving. I would personally like to see a 2.5 hour day remain, but not link the number of years or seasons to this figure.
Yeah, Victoria, I misread your question and I haven't had a chance to respond to it, and it keeps perpetuating. We shifted the time schedule to make sure that the days moved along the way we wanted it to, but it's still 4 days. It's 1 day per season. It is not a 25-hour season, it is a 24-hour season.
Okay, so it's going to be a 24-hour season.
Yes. So
fantastic.
That Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, you know, those 4 days are going to be each one season, and it'll loop around. The fact that there are 7 days in a week as opposed to 8 means that we don't have to worry about it, because every Monday will be a different season either way.
All right. Fantastic. We're getting our responses back in chat now. They're saying, go on, go on. So, okay.
All right. I guess we're going on.
Yeah, we're going on. All right. Hoxon asks, I think my biggest worry is the time scaling. Feels rushed. I would like to experience each season and day, but when they're whipping by at, you know, the light speed, I feel like I'm watching the world fast forward. And you know, that kind of does have a feeling of claustrophobia. I kind of get the feeling that he's talking about.
Yeah, so the seasons is the one that people tend to come down to, the fact that it's 1 day per season. There are many different systems that are at play there. There is combat and military. So for example, you march out to invade a neighboring county and you happen to time it such that it's winter and we have 4 days of winter and your entire troop is just out there in the snow for 4 days and there's nothing they can really do about it. They're moving extremely slow. They're cold. Their fatigue is dropping rapidly. It's just not a great experience. Likewise, for the farmers, you know, they want to plant and yeah, they can do things throughout the day that will allow them to continue their farming profession other than just planting and gathering. But the reality is that, you know, having 2 or 4 days between when they plant and when they harvest, it's going to be kind of boring for them. And then the other thing to note is that you guys will run out of food. So we could double the food, but there are other problems with that as well. Ultimately, we went with a system that feels like it's natural. And yes, one day it's spring, the next day it's summer, the next day it's fall and winter. But honestly, it doesn't feel like it's going to be that big of a deal. This is one of those that once players get in, we really want to see what their thoughts are. Until players are actually in the world and are seeing the seasons go by one day at a time. We don't plan on making any changes there.
I think perhaps like you know, the way I look at this is that I'm playing in summer, and then it comes fall the next day, and then before I log out, I gotta think to myself, oh, I better make sure I have my furs on my inventory.
That's a good point. So Victoria has actually touched on that as well. There are different regions in the world, as you can imagine, longitude, latitude, and different latitudes have different temperatures, and the longitudes, depending upon whether or not you're living in a rain shadow or not, will determine how much water you get and what the temperature ranges are and that sort of thing. But in general, if you live in a region that is moderately temperature, you know, moderate around the equator, you're not going to see a huge variation in temperature each day. You'll see the seasons change and maybe the colors of the leaves change and that sort of thing, but it's not going to be more dramatic than that. If you live in an area that's, you know, snowy or becomes snowy, that's just going to be kind of one of those things you have to deal with living in an area like that. But it is something that we do here. It is something that we are paying attention to. We have talked about not going any further than 2 days, but making it so that the seasons span years. So you have a 6 month period of time where it's winter and a 6 month time where it's spring, et cetera, so that it does actually make it so that it's one season longer than, basically you don't see all four seasons in a single year. It would take 2 years to see all four seasons. It's something that we can do without actually affecting the gameplay mechanics too much, aside from the things I pointed out earlier. But again, until we get in and actually play it and find out how it feels with the 1 day per season and kind of what the variations are in temperature and stuff, depending upon where people reside, we're just not going to make changes until we get into game and see.
All right, fantastic. So basically, what you're kind of explaining is the regions will have biomes.
There are like 13 biomes. So yeah, there are different biomes, and many of the biomes aren't going to experience a huge range in temperature. You'll want to make sure that you either always have light clothes or always have, you know, a heavy cloak, but you're not going to see huge swings from one season to the next in most areas.
Got it. All right. That's a great answer to that question. Thank you. I think we got a bit more than we bargained for in that one. That's 13 biomes. That's impressive. Okay, moving on. World size. Sinian asks, they talk about a huge world, and it's always changing in some way, shape, or form, but will there really be enough to explore, or will most of the world just be open flat land with little things here and there?
No, it will not be mostly open flat land with little things here and there to explore. We don't have spawn points, and we don't have, you know, rogue camps and that sort of thing like that near towns. So what happens are things like NPCs in a town have a personality that might lead them to want to become criminals. They have they're extremely extroverted and have good leadership, so they're able to attract followers. And so they start migrating out of town one day, maybe every couple of hours, one of them leaves, and they set up a camp outside of town somewhere. Maybe it's a mile away, maybe it's 10 miles away, but they set up a base of operations there. And from there, they plan, a bigger storyline. What we're planning to do is we have the ability to keep track of where the majority of players go. So if they're mostly, they're hotspots, basically. We have a map of hotspots that says, okay, most people are congregating around here, and there's nobody really touching this area over here. It's been a long time since anybody's been there. And so that's a perfect place for us to set up a rogue encampment or take one of those dragons that we were talking about and having them put a nest in one of those nearby mountains that nobody's exploring anymore. And ultimately, make things happen there. So it's actually going to be those open lands that you're talking about where nobody goes, where the most interesting and exciting things are going to happen. So we really want people going out and exploring those frequently.
Okay, I think you answered that one pretty thoroughly. Fifth Guard's question is, my main concern with the game being so focused around player interaction is that my personal experience will then become limited purely because other players aren't actually around to interact with. And I've actually heard this from a lot of different people.
Mm-hmm. So he continues on talking about the gaming hours. So there's really two things about that. Number one, when we launch the servers, we're going to do so with a single continent. And we're going to populate, we don't have starting realms per se, there's no starting towns, but we do plan on exposing families that are kind of in common regions. So we want to fill up one region before we start populating another region. And in doing so, then we have fairly populated areas even from the beginning. And then by not having the whole world exposed at the beginning and forcing players to explore in order to grow out, we make sure that there's always kind of players around from a family standpoint. So there's always people around. As per normal gaming hours, that's something entirely different. The family system does allow you to ask for a family that's going to be playing around the same time of day as you, using time zones and other things. So that kind of helps you find a family that's going to be playing at the same time as you. And we also do plan to do regional servers. So we'll do North America server, we'll do some EU servers, we'll probably do an Australia server. And the reason that we can do that, and this is probably more than you guys need to know, but our servers are all hosted in the cloud. They're dynamic, they're designed to expand and contract based on load balancing needs. And so any regions that support our cloud infrastructure framework, we can actually host servers in that region. And that gives us the opportunity then to go up and show up in a couple different locales. So we're hoping that between having regional servers and the ability to pick families that are going to be playing at the same time as you, combined with the fact that the world will feel very small in the beginning and then grow from there, that it shouldn't be hard for you to find people to play on or play with, especially because we're trying to fit 100,000 players on a single server. So there you go.
So your answer then raised yet another concern for me.
Sure.
One of the things that you talk about in your design journals is this idea of bloodlines. And yep. Depending on what region your family is from, you have different bonuses to certain attributes. So say, for example, I personally am particularly interested in living in the desert because I like mm-hmm. this idea of having a high endurance, high agility type player. Being a desert drifter is actually kind of exciting for me, especially as an explorer, combat type minded individual. At game launch, will I actually have access to join that kind of bloodline, or will I be locked to a region because that's where everybody's spawning out of?
No, so what will happen is we'll open up many of the different biomes, not all of them, but a lot of the main ones so that people can create characters in those regions. But rather than having families across three different towns or three different villages in a single biome, we'll limit it to one region in a biome. So that way all the players are kind of showing up in the same village before expanding out to other villages. So that way we get the best of both worlds. There are opportunities for players to live in different regions, but when settling in that region, they all kind of settle in the same place initially.
Okay, cool. That answers my question. The next question is about our family system. It's the only question about our family system, and this comes from Prime. Another fear I have is not being able to comfortably play with friends. Say, me and a friend both join up, and I want the blacksmith, and he wants to be a champion, so we cannot even pick the same family, even if we could only one can inherit. Okay, you get the idea.
Just get that part, yeah. Yep. So I think this one actually was answered on the forum by a couple of community members. But the idea is that there's many different ways to play with someone. Families and being in the same family is not a prerequisite to playing with your friends. You could be neighbors. You know, you could live in different families in the same village. You could start in different villages and travel and group up together and become, you know, long best friends that party together. But even within the same family, you know, you can both choose to find a family that has one parent as a blacksmith and one as a champion, because certainly those could exist. Or you could just find a family that fits one of you and both join it as siblings with the understanding that, you know, one of you is going to really benefit from the parent's skills while the other one's not so much. But those are really only your starting skills. Keep in mind that your soul ramp contributes, a skill ramp from your soul contributes to a lot of what you're going to end up doing from a start. So if you pick a soul that was, let's say, a champion in a previous life, you're going to ramp up on those skills pretty quickly, regardless of whether or not your character starts with those. And so you shouldn't let the parents that are available really limit your story. You can still live the story that you want to. It just might be that you didn't start from a family of champions or blacksmiths, but you chose to go different from the family, to choose an occupation different than the family's occupation and strike out on your own. And that's a good story too.
I think, you know, this concern kind of does stem from the weight associated with family selection. I believe that the actual design journal called it a critical decision. Mm-hmm. Would it be fair to say that somebody who starts in a family of champions would have an advantage over somebody who starts in a family of blacksmiths? Because really that's where this concern is stemming from.
Yeah, no, absolutely. There's no question that if you want to play a champion and you start in a family of both champion parents, that your skill sets are going to come with a boost because you were taught how to be a champion as a child. But that's kind of the trade-off that players are going to ultimately have to make is do they want to play within the same family as a friend of theirs and be siblings, or do they want to min-max in order to create the best champion they possibly can? We actually hope that people do choose to be in the same family so that they can be in the same location. So they have a shared bloodline so that they have that kind of connection, the ability to chat with each other, even when they're not near each other on the same continent, to come to each other's rescue when one of them gets felled. We feel like those trade-offs are worth not being able to min-max as much, you know, based on that. But, you know, there are going to be many different play styles, many different people who want to do different things. Some people are looking at NTCs and other things. So at this point, it's one of those where we have to get in and play it. But we're pretty comfortable with the mechanics thus far, and they feel pretty balanced so far.
Okay, fantastic. We're going to move on to skills and a skill system. Sinian asks, after being reborn, yes, you start over. However, let's say I was master in some form of combat.
I'll summarize this one for you because the grammar on this one was a rough one.
Yes,
basically, I think this one and the one after that. This one and the third one. Basically, what it comes down to is if I'm a level one warrior champion, let's say I'm a level one in the sword, single one-handed sword skill. But I'm really good as a player. You know, I've been playing fighting games my whole life. I've got good dexterity. I'm good, you know, fast reflexes. And I encounter somebody in the wild who's a level 70. They're a master swordsman. Can I expect to beat them? And this again goes back to the we're going to have to get in and play with it a little bit. Ultimately, it's a balance. It's kind of 50-50 player versus character skill. Maybe 60-40 in favor of players. We do want players that are skilled to be able to be on par with or better than those who aren't as skilled. But we also want to take into account people who paid their dues. They've developed some advanced skills. I can't talk about combat too much without going into detail, so I have to be very careful what I say. Let's put it this way. If you're really good at fighting games or this style, not even fighting games, that's a bad way to say it. If you are comfortable in a combat system, and you encounter somebody who is not, there's a good chance you'll be able to beat them regardless of what their character's skill level is within some margin. There will be a point at which it will become extremely challenging for you to beat them because a master or grandmaster swordsman is a grandmaster swordsman. Like, they've earned their way up there. They know things that you don't. They've, you know, spent the time in training and practice. And so while their reflexes might not be as fast, it's skill versus will. It's skill versus knowledge. But that being said, we don't expect someone who is, and I'm using levels as an example, expect someone who's a level 10 one-handed swordsman to always beat somebody who's a level 5 or even a level 1. The ranges of levels aren't that, not impactful, that's not the right word to use, but it's much more about your experience and kind of what you've done. But yeah, best way I can describe it is that within some margin, I would expect lower level skilled characters who have skilled players to still be able to best their superiors.
Okay. Let's move on to the next question. Alyssa Imagine asks, one thing I worry about is that the skills are easier to get than the devs believe. I talk to my boyfriend about this game all the time, so we have discussions, and as he had pointed out, there are many games that tell us the game will take a ton of time to achieve high-ranking skills, like, for example, Final Fantasy XIV. Posted such things, but they, you know, ended up actually achieving max skills in 2 weeks. So how are you going to, I guess, more or less balance progression so it does take several lifetimes to kind of hit that legendary status?
Right. So I originally released the design journal on the skill system with some wording that I was not pleased with, which is why when I put it on our website, I went back and I edited it for clarity. The way we've established the skill system is like so. We said, let's assume for a moment that somebody were to sit down and work on a single skill every second of every day as though they didn't have a job, they didn't have school, they didn't have anything. How long do we want them to take to achieve legendary status if that's what they're doing, if that's their MO? And we said, well, you know, we still want it to take several lifetimes, even if they were to do it every second of every day, because we feel like to achieve legendary, that's how long it takes, is every second of every day for a couple of lifetimes. So we know that it's impossible from the outset for people to get there in just by grinding because of diminishing returns. So if you continue to craft the same thing over and over again, you learn less from it. So it's asymptotic. You're going to get to the point where trying to gain skill from crafting the same thing isn't going to work anymore. It's not going to prove beneficial. So you're going to have to constantly to move on to new and more challenging things. But even if you were to do that, it's still going to take you a really long time to reach mastery in a specific skill. That's why we introduced item mastery. So you can become a master at crafting a specific item even before you become a master at crafting a specific skill. We want to reward people for doing the things that they want to do without requiring them to grind and that sort of stuff. With that being said, the way that the skill system works, as we said, we want people to spend 3 years or three lifetimes to get to a point where they're a legendary character. For example, that's not exactly true, but bear with me. What we can do is we can watch the servers and we can see how long it's taking people and whether or not they're on the right trajectory. And if we see that people are taking longer than expected, that they're not progressing as fast as we would like, then we can actually give them a little bit of bonus. We can lower the curve to make it easier. So while we know the worst case scenario, we've optimized around making it easier in order to meet that timeline, as opposed to many of these other games where they don't ahead of time calculate how long they want players to take to get there. They just say, well, this is how long we think they should spend crafting. It should take about a minute and a half, and et cetera. And then they take for granted the fact that people really are willing to sit there and do that every single minute of every single day to get to the end goal. And part of that has to do with the fact that you have to be max level to benefit in a lot of the existing games. And in our game, you don't have to do that. So there, all of this discussion aside, there's less incentive to even try. You know, if you can make the item that you want to at high skill level at the time in which you need it, why really grind to max level? You know, it's about the journey, not the destination.
Well, I guess maybe, and this is a follow-up question.
Sure.
If it takes three lifetimes to hit what many would consider level 50 max level, I mean, you are talking about 3 years. I mean, when you said 3 years, that does sound about accurate. So with that being said, will progression feel sluggish or slow? Like, I feel like I've hit a wall and I'm really just not learning anything new. I mean, what are you going to do to kind of help people, even though it is taking them a while to get to that legendary status? But you know, progression is fun. Does that just simply mean that it, you know, really, if you think about it, it's like, well, you're level one and you're going to a level 1,000 and it's going to take you 3 years to get to a level 1,000. But along the way, you're going to feel progression smoothly from here till now.
The way that we're looking at doing it is on a 100-point scale. And so you'd expect that 100-point to take roughly 3 lifetimes or 3 years. And the way we solve that is by making each point after about 50 or 60 to be meaningful. So you go up that 1 point and there's cause for celebration because it's a recognition that you've gone up 1/100th, you know, 1% better than you were before. And with that comes the ability to potentially work with different types of things that you couldn't work with before or at higher skill level and that sort of thing. But again, our focus isn't necessarily on making sure that the best things can be done at the high levels. It's on making sure that it's a tiered approach so that even at lower levels, you can still contribute to the story. You know, I know how to make swords. I'm an expert in making swords. I'm not a level 100 blacksmith, but I don't need to be in order to contribute and to make an income and to make good swords. And that's true whether you're talking about crafting professions or combat. You know, you don't have to be level 100 in order to be productive.
Okay. So we'll move on to the next question. Solon asks, and this is actually a pretty good question in my mind. My main concern is that I may be stuck in one role and not have the skills to multitask. So basically, I'm a blacksmith. All I do is blacksmith, blacksmith, blacksmith. After maybe a couple months of doing that, I'm going to feel a little tired of it.
We hope so. Our goal is to make this game dynamic. That's why we have people aging, so that as they grow old, their physical skills start to decline and their mental skills start to increase and their social skills kind of, you know, half and half. We want people to transition from one roles to another. We want them to be, you know, warriors and champions when they're in their youth, and then moving on to more kind of an exploratory role in their middle age, and then maybe become a producer in their elder years. We want people to do that. As to your specific question as well, you know, there's going to be some people who min-max and say, I want to be the best blacksmith I can. And so they focus on joining a family that's a blacksmith, and they focus on in their youth during their adolescence, training those blacksmithing skills to get them up as quickly as they can. And each incarnation, they, you know, make sure to level up that skill ramp in blacksmithing as soon as they possibly can. And they're kind of doing it to themselves. You know, there's nothing preventing players from saying, I'm going to grow up in a family of blacksmiths, but I'm going to work on my explorer skills. And so what happens is they get to go out and explore and do things, but they can always come back to town and use what they learned from their parents to be blacksmiths, you know, make some money, make some coin, and then fund their real passion. So they can have hobbies in addition to what they really do. And You got multiple lifetimes to build the character that you want to. People, I really don't want them to think about their character as a single lifetime. It's 10 years or it's multiple lives. And so you have all the time in the world to experience every skill. Mix and match, do something new, come up with a character that you feel is fun to play. What I love hearing on IRC and in chat are people talking about the specific character they want to create. I think Chronicles of Elyria, more than any other game, gives you the ability to define a persona. I'm going to be Robin Hood. Now I'm going to rob from the rich and steal from the poor. In order to do that, I need to have a certain amount of survival skills because I need the stealth associated with that. I also need the ability to stay out in the woods for a long period of time. I also need the ability to fight, obviously. So I need some combat skills in there as well. And then when I'm resting, I'm going to play my lute because I'm a musical bardish kind of character, in addition to being a warrior slash or champion slash survival character. So I've created this persona, and I can alternate between those skills, developing them in turn. If my persona is I'm a blacksmith, then yeah, it may eventually get boring.
All right, Caspian, I'm taking a look at this list of questions. We are literally at the bottom of page two of five pages. So that being said, there are actually people who are diligently working at some transcribing this, even though I will actually push this up for people to watch. But I think that it would be wise that maybe we go ahead and touch on these in a next part two session. And I do believe that we were already planning on doing this again next week. Is that correct?
So, I really do appreciate having you on the show and us answering these because I wanted these were important enough that I felt like we needed to answer these questions in person, and that just typing the answers out on the forums didn't do the they didn't do the questions justice. I think these were well thought out, they were well worded, they're serious concerns, and there are things that need to be addressed. So I felt like doing them in a voice format was great, and I'm glad that you were willing to step forward and let me do that. However, we do want to get to a point where we're able to do our live chats kind of thing eventually on our own channel and stuff like that. So we're not sure yet what how quickly we're going to be able to get a studio set up or do something like that, whether or not it's going to be next week or sometime beyond that. But I think for the time being, since we don't have this list answered yet, we should plan to do it whether or not it's next week, same bat time, same bat channel, or if it's before then, to make sure that we can get these kind of all answered sooner rather than later. I think I'll leave that up to you.
Okay, well, I already have a couple dates and times in mind, so I'll send that out to you, and then we'll publish the time and hopefully get everybody out there again.
Sounds good. Personal note to the community, thank you guys for those of you who are following along. Thank you for those who are taking time to provide your concerns for us so that we know what people are thinking. Obviously, it's difficult from a developer standpoint when we are listening to the community to know kind of what the temperature is. We want to make sure that people like what we're doing. But at the same time, we have to take some of it with a grain of salt. And when people spend the time to, really eloquently express their concerns like this, it makes our job easy because then we know, the community cares about the game. That is the thing that's most important to us, is that we're super impressed with how much the community has responded to the game and how much they care about what we're doing. Just thank you to the community. Keep supporting us, and we will continue to try and make the game that we want to make, which we believe thus far is also the game you want us to make.
Guys, so much for watching. This has been a great opportunity to have Caspian here. Caspian, thank you so much for coming by to the channel. It was quite an honor having you, and I think we learned an awful lot about this about your title, Chronicles of Elyria. I myself am very excited for it to come out, and I think a lot of people were kept extremely busy transcribing a lot of the information that you gave out today. So thank you very much for the opportunity for us to actually distribute that information, and it was an absolute honor having you.
Thank you. My pleasure.
All right, fantastic. Guys, thank you so much for watching. This was Bicycle Walrus with Caspian, otherwise known as Jeromy Walsh, who is the technical director and CEO of Soulbound Studios, talking about his upcoming title, Chronicles of Elyria. Thank you guys so much for watching, and we'll see you next time.
Larger story. And so it uses that opportunity to give you that talent. So I don't want to encourage people to go out and do heroic things because they feel like the Soulborn engine will save them. And that it will give them the talent at the last minute. But it's true that going out and doing those types of heroic things and becoming an active part of the story will end up giving you a talent more often than not. And by not, I mean not more often than not doing it. I mean, if you weren't planning on having a talent, or if the engine wasn't going to give you a talent to begin with, if your character, when it was randomly created, didn't have a talent, your chances of getting one is much higher if you integrate yourself into the story than if you don't.
All right, knowing that we have limited time, I'm going to move on to the next question, though I'm dying to ask more about that particular subject. But we're talking about story, and Prime asks, well, how will players even know what their story is? I mean, it is random for every soul, and I haven't seen much on it. Can you elaborate on destinies and how the destiny will actually interact with the player's story?
Absolutely. So we talked about this in one of the previous design journals. It was like around design journal 3 or 4. And the Soulborne engine is a multi-layered system. And what I mean by that is that there are things happening at different levels. Animals, you know, are constantly, there's an ecosystem. And if you go out and kill, you know, a slew of animals, then it's going to break the ecosystem. And that's going to cause a chain of events, which will ultimately lead to some kind of scenario. There will be a story element there. I hate to say quest because that word is overused, and it's something we try and avoid using in Chronicles of Elyria if we can, but think of it as a quest. You know, there will be a quest that will come as a result of the fact that there's an imbalance in the ecosystem. That's a result of player action, but it's not really tied into either the story engine or the destiny engine. It's just a result of player actions. It's cause and effect. It's consequences for the things that they do in the world. But as a result of the things that they do, it gives them other things to do. And so that's one of the ways why we try and keep the players engaged. Then there is this concept of the personal story, and that's tied to your birth date. So from the moment your character is born into the world, they have a series of tasks that are going to be assigned to them. And again, it's randomly distributed based on your birth date. So without going too much into the astrology of it, you might find that for one reason or another, your character is destined to always oppose women. I'm using that as a random example because that was a conversation I was having with my wife recently. But because of this, your character just struggles with the opposite gender. We don't know why, it just does. And so as a result of that, you might find that as you travel from town to town, women whose NPCs, whose personality traits, which we use the big five personality model, we might find that
you're
women
referring
who are
to Ocean there, correct?
Correct. You might find that the women you encounter, the NPCs you encounter, who aren't open to you, based on the openness attribute, tend to give you a hard time. Maybe they send you to do tasks which are counterproductive. They just kind of troll you. And so your story is that you are constantly being trolled by the women in your life. And that's something that, you know, we didn't plan for necessarily. It's just kind of how the engine worked out based on the results that we came up with for your specific character. So it's not something that you have to look for. It's not something that you're going to have to try and hunt down for your story. It's just going to be your play experience. And you're going to know it because wherever you go, however you play, things are popping up which are presenting themselves as things for you to do, which are all based on your personal story. That's one layer. And I'm going to regret using that example about the versus women.
No, it reminds me. It reminds me of a fan fiction I once wrote for COE. Anyways.
So there you go. So, yeah, and that actually is what sparked that conversation. We can follow up on that offline. There's obviously the Destiny engine as well. And the Destiny engine is a higher level part of the story engine. So it's not just your birth date, but there is this overall 10-year story. And I like to compare it to a choose your own adventure book where there is lots of different choices at any one point in time. There isn't a single outcome. There might be a dozen possible outcomes. And we break the story up. You guys have never heard this before, but I'll say that we chose Chronicles of Elyria as opposed to World of Elyria or Elyria Online or, you know, some of any of the other names, because the concept of Chronicles to us speaks to us of text, of books, you know, of epic novels. And that's kind of what we wanted to recreate with this game, was this idea of you living out an epic story. And so we kind of had divided up this 10-year story into books. And each book is going to last about a year. So there's about 10 books in this story. And these books are further divided up into chapters. And the chapters for us could be months, for example. Hmm. And what happens is that at the transition point, at the inflection between one chapter and another, we don't really know what the players are going to do and how they're going to come out of that chapter. But what we do know is that at any point in time, the engine is looking at how close you are to one of the possible outcomes, and it's trying to drive you to one of those outcomes. So it's introducing quests, it's creating conflict, it's creating NPCs that have certain personalities in order for them to grow up and cause conflict. It's driving the story towards one of those outcomes. But the choices that the players make might steer them towards one of the others, And as soon as they do, then it adds weight to that. It adds credibility to it, and it drives them to that other story outcome instead. And so the whole engine is built around this concept of triggers, things that players can do, and eventual outcomes. And it might be that they start heading in a direction that we didn't anticipate at all. And it has the potential to do something that's just cataclysmic or fantastic or awesome or whatever. And that's why we're not writing the whole story up front. We do have a plan to have an overall storyline, but we will have writers on staff so that as things kind of progress, we have the opportunity to respond to things as necessary. But again, this isn't something players need to look for. It's something that they're going to be involved in, whether they know it or not.
Okay, real quick, I did kind of want to point at something real quick. You know, the story engine, I think one of the concerns that people might have if you bring it up is that, well, is it going to make me do something I really don't want to do? And I remember something from a design journal that was basically suggesting that the Soulborn engine takes into account your affinity. If you're light attuned or dark attuned. So this wouldn't really put anybody in a position to go against the type of character that they've developed or a persona that they developed for themselves, correct?
Correct. So it's important to call out that what's presented to the characters in general is not going to be a quest to go do something. What's presented to the characters is a conflict. It's a struggle. It's a problem. And how the player chooses to solve that problem is up to them. And then as their affinity guides them towards one way or the other, then the problems will be indicated. It will be clear what the intended outcome is, but the players still have an opportunity to either fulfill the requirement or to go opposite to it. But what we're really using, when I talked about the birth dates and the conflict and the things that are likely to happen to a player, I should have been very specific in saying that the conflicts, that, for example, with the women, that, you know, wherever you go, you're always in conflict with women. You have an opportunity to choose how you resolve those conflicts. There might be multiple different ways to solve those conflicts, some on the light side, some on the dark side. So, yeah.
We're going to move on to the next story question, which is from Alyssal Imagine, or Alyssal Imagine. And her question is, I worry without raids, there won't be any really strong monsters that you need more than one person to defeat. What's your response to that?
So I was looking through this list of questions, and I chose to put that one in the story category as opposed to like the content category or something like that, to remind myself how to answer this question, which is, if you've read any of the lore by Inara Starsong, you already know there is belief that the ancients, these anti-Peruvians, have been awakened. And I wouldn't say there aren't going to be any really strong monsters in the world for you to defeat. I'll just leave it at that.
Oh, okay. We're going to move on to fantasy versus realism, which is a rather larger topic. It's one of our larger ones for tonight. Ender asks, I'm worried about the non-realistic elements. I don't like having sorcerers, dragons, vampires, and whatnot running around. Those are exactly the things that can unbalance the game. An overpowered sorcerer, a powerful vampire, an immortal army, etc. And so really what this is kind of getting to is game balance. You know, traditionally MMORPGs, everybody's balanced. Everybody is the same power level, maybe different roles, but otherwise they have the same power level. And so maybe that's kind of where his concern is coming from, is the traditional sense of MMORPGs.
So I also put the story section right below this fantasy versus realism to remind myself to flow from Alyssal Imagine's question into this one, which she says, I worry without raids that there won't be any really strong monsters that, you know, you need to, that might require more than one person to defeat. And then immediately after that, Ender calls out that, you know, there are going to be these overpowered sorcerers, powerful vampires, immortal armies, and that sort of thing. And that those cause a problem with game balance. And actually, Ender's question is my solution to the previous question, which is that we have intentionally introduced the opportunity for players in the world to become overpowered, to become unbalanced, the ability to become a superpowered sorcerer, the ability to become, you know, the most powerful vampire, or the, you know, the head of an entire coven of vampires, or even, you know, the rumor of there being the ability to become a lich and having, you know, this immortal army, or, you know, necromancy, the ability to raise the dead. Those are not going to be things that are going to sit well with most players. And so the objective here is that when somebody does become the overpowered sorcerer or the powerful vampire, that everybody else who's looking for a raid boss now finds one. And so it's our intention that these unbalances create player content. That's kind of, it's by design.
Okay. That, you know, and you know, kind of thinking about that, it's, In a world where obviously permadeath is a thing and you have these ultra powerful players, you know, I can immediately see the concern that someone might have of is like, well, these ultra powerful players are now taking not only my character's life into their hands, but my pocketbooks into their hands. And so, you know, and we know that the Soulborn engine is smart enough to distinguish the difference between a PC and an NPC. Is it smart enough to distinguish the difference between a PC with talents versus a PC without talents? And would the risk be lowered for trying to go after these guys?
I'm not sure I fully understand the question.
So basically, if I'm killed by a PC, the Soulborn engine recognizes that, okay, he was killed by a PC, his spirit loss from spirit walking will be, you know, a certain amount. Mm-hmm. Now I'm killed by a PC with talents. So I decided to go after them, or they decided to grief me because they're overpowered. Because you're introducing an overpowered player who now can take my pocketbook and my experience into their hands. Is there a way to kind of balance out the penalties from being, I guess, murdered by these people?
Sure. So obviously there's a lot of areas in here where we're not going to know. Generally, anytime we approach a problem, we know, okay, there's a sweet spot here. There's going to be a place where things feel too overpowered, and that these overpowered players really become so overpowered, there's nothing anybody can do about it. And on the other end, there is these players who become overpowered so little that nobody really notices that they even exist, and that they have power, but it's useless by and large, and it's not creating the story that we want to. It's not creating conflict. Anytime we look at one of those and we know that there's dials that we need to tweak and figure it out, we kind of look to play test to solve those problems. We want to get players into the world in alpha and in beta and have these vampires and sorcerers running around so that we can really see what it takes for them to incite a revolt. You know, how powerful does a vampire have to be before the village rises up with pitchforks and attacks them? On the other hand, we want to find out, you know, if we make the vampire that powerful, what's the real cost to the community? As it stands now, there's no checks and balances in place because it's pretty early on. But again, we want the powerful vampires and the overpowered sorcerers to make people want to attack them. And if they're this super powerful vampire that's living quietly in their castle on the edge of the village, not really doing anything, then we're kind of failing from story writer perspective, because we've introduced something that should cause story that's not. And so we need to make them overpowered enough so that it creates the opportunity for story.
Got it. Okay. Moving on to the next question. Gunholio is basically asking, it's a very long question, but I'm going to kind of summarize it here.
Well, with vampires sparkle.
Yes, vampires, do they sparkle? Are you drawing inspiration from Twilight for vampires?
No, vampires don't sparkle. We've mentioned before that you won't actually be able to tell easily whether or not somebody is a vampire. Because if you've got this very powerful vampire who's doing very bad things and everybody wants to rise up and find them, part of the story is detecting who it is. You know, it's a game of murder mystery. And so if they sparkled in the daylight, that would be a little bit easy. What I can say is that the next design journal, we talk a little bit about anonymity as part of our discussion on identities and disguises and reputation. And one of the things we talk about is how you can throw on a cloak. And when you throw on a cloak, even if you recognize someone previously, even if you know who they are by sight, and they do have that little name tag over their head because you've encountered them enough that you want to be able to spot them in a crowd. If somebody throws the cloak over their head, they're not going to be spottable out in daylight or even at night. You're not going to know who they are. And that same cloak can be used by vampires to allow them to move about between buildings during daytime. So you'll probably look suspicious at someone if it's middle of the day and they're walking around in a cloak. And if you're a sheriff or somebody who has the legal reason to do so, you might want to go up and have a conversation with them. But in general, vampires are very powerful. And they only get more powerful as time goes on. And they are strong. I'm looking at the conversation here. They are strong, fast, and they are powerful. People who become
vampires, burn in daylight.
They do burn in daylight. There is a dot that hits them in daylight if they are disrobed, or if their cloak is removed from them, or if they are, you know, otherwise engaged in combat, and they cannot use their abilities during the daytime where the dot starts as well. So as far as we know at this point, daylight and one other way are the only two ways to defeat a vampire.
Okay, real quick, for those who are uninitiated, dots means damage over time. So it's like you're poisoned in the daylight.
Oh, come on. I gotta... I'm hoping the audience knows that.
Just in case. You never know who's listening.
You never know. That's true.
All right. Well, I think we've gotten through about vampires enough. Let's move on to the next question, because I feel like this one's going to generate a lot of conversation. The game's focus on realism and not being a WoW clone, I really don't think that's the focus. It just happens to not be one. Will lead to devs implementing some game mechanics that are simply not fun. Some of the mechanics sound nice in theory, but I'm fearing that they will not be enjoyable for some players when implemented.
I'm going to touch on a couple different parts of that. There is a focus on realism, but it's realism for a purpose. If you look at a game like Ark Survival Evolved, they have realism for the purpose of having realism. They want to create that realistic feeling. They want you out in the wild. They want you afraid. Like you're wandering around in a world of dinosaurs. So you want that heartbeat. You want that suspense. You need to make sure you're keeping track of a lot of different things at once.
I'll never forget the first time my wife and I were chased by a T-Rex in that game. Just saying.
Yeah, there was swearing, I'm sure. There was in my house. There was much swearing. Followed by it's big, but we'll forgo the first word. The realism for us is a means to an end, and I can't stress that enough. We've got a lot of realistic elements in here. We've got the need for food, we've got the need for water, we've got the need for sleep. But those are our means to an end. They're not the focus of the game, and we don't want them to be the foreground. We're working on systems to try and make them, you know, there and something you're aware of, but not overbearing. Like if you're in town, you know, the need to go into a tavern or something like that to socialize. This is an example of us using food in town as a means to an end. It's a way to get people to socialize and to congregate in a place other than in front of an auction house, which obviously is going to be less common with live auction houses anyways. But that being said, the real reason we have these realism mechanics is so that we give opportunities for dynamic story. You're out in the world. It's nighttime. At night, your fatigue goes down quicker than it does during day. So it's a good time to rest. I mean, you could rest in the day, obviously, but it's a good time to do it at night. That requires you pitch a tent or a campsite, and you want food and you want water and you need the things that you're going to do. We also give people the opportunity to play some card games and some dice games and some, you know, they can sing and do their bardic things while they're gathered around the campfire and tell stories and all that. But the real reason we do that is really so that you have to set up a tent and light a fire if you want cooked food. Anybody that's watched or read Lord of the Rings remembers the scene where the party is out in the middle of the plains and they find, of course, the highest point they can find, and they light a fire in the middle of the night, which draws the attention of everybody around. And that's what we're trying to recreate is this scenario where you march, you know, all day and halfway through the night to a nearby, you know, county or duchy that you're trying to invade. There's a castle there that's got an ancient evil in it or whatever the specific scenario is. You get there, you realize it's the middle of the night, you're tired, you're within eyeshot of this, you know, ancient keep. Are you really going to pitch a tent in the middle of the wild at night and start a fire so that you can recoup that energy? Or are you going to choose instead to sleep in the dark, you know, in the cold, and risk, you know, anything around you that you can't see coming into your campsite? Or, you know, potentially not sleeping and engaging the ancient keep not fully rested the next day. So it's an opportunity for players to think about how they want to approach the scenario, and we just use these realism mechanics as a way to drive those. Go ahead.
Okay, so I think you touched on a lot of the fun parts about realism. Yep. What about the not-so-fun parts about realism? So you and I have both played Ark Survival Evolved, and you notice that as time goes on, you realize, okay, before I can go here and do this, I have to go here and do that. I have to gather up the food, I have to cook the food, put most of it away in the refrigerator. I'm going to have to jerky it now so that way it lasts a little longer. And now that I got all that done, now I got to craft all these arrows, I got to go do this, I got to go do that. And everything becomes a chore before you can actually start playing the game. And I think that's kind of a bane, if you will, to the realism, is that will this become a chore, or is it being designed in such a way where it will not?
It's being designed in such a way that it will not. Again, that goes back to the dials. We'll know once we get people in and playing it whether or not something becomes tiring after a month or a week or 2 months or whatever the time frame is. But also, the use of offline player characters to do a lot of the more mundane tasks, preparing the food and stuff like that, as well as having people whose careers are bakers and stuff like that, means that people who have a passion for those things, who are less likely to get bored by those things, can focus on those things. And those who don't really want to spend the time cooking meals and doing that sort of thing, they could just, you know, buy their rations from a nearby, you know, pub or tavern and take them with them on the way out onto their journey. We really do want to make these realism mechanics fall sort of into the background. You know, it's kind of like, what was the analogy that I heard recently? It's one of those things where the better it is, the less you notice it. And if people are noticing it, then we need to reevaluate it because we don't want that to become the focus of the game.
While at the same time, it is a survival game.
It is.
I mean, like, I feel like I had to bring that up only because I love the concept of this being a survival game so much. Starving to death, which has almost happened to me several times in Ark, I'll get rescued by somebody at the last second. I mean, literally, someone will pass me a steak and boom, I'm like, oh, thank goodness, you saved me. We're still going to have those moments when you're out in the wilderness, correct?
Yeah. So it's one of those things where we want it to become a background thing until it's not. You know, it should be a background thing to prepare food. It should be a background thing to sit and eat. You should want to sit and eat because it's a good time to socialize and do other things that you're more interested in doing. But if you don't do those things, if you fail to do it, if those background tasks become, you know, forgotten completely, then we do want those side effects because there's story in those too. If you don't prepare enough food and you're out in the middle of the desert or water, then that's a story in itself. So,
or you get raided by bandits and they take all your food.
Exactly. I'm actually waiting for that. I mean, I relish the day when somebody comes and robs me of my food and leaves me there, like strapped to a wagon with nothing but my, you know, underbreeches. And they don't kill me. They're just like, all right, well, we're going to take your food and leave you, you know, in your underpants. That will be awesome. There will be many screenshots of that.
You're thinking along the same exact lines I'm thinking. All right, next question. So this is kind of on, you know, the opposite end of the spectrum. So we know the realism is a big focus in this game. Has to be. It's a survival game. But I know it's a huge, I'm getting into this question. So Justeric asks, the realism. I know it's a huge selling point as well, but I fear the lack of some of the traditional fantasy elements, the unfair nature, and the aging system will thin the herd dramatically and make for a hard game to maintain. So basically he's fearing that the lack of fantasy elements might actually be a bane to the game as well.
Possibly. The best answer I have for that is that there are sci-fi games that don't have fantasy elements, and there are obviously modern games that don't have fantasy elements, and then there are fantasy, high fantasy games that obviously do. I'm going to come back to this analogy many times probably during this Q&A, but somebody raised this question recently, or there was a conversation, I don't remember who actually said this, and so if you watch this live stream, and you do, if this was you, then please remind me, but I was having a conversation with somebody recently, and they said that the Chronicles of Elyria is like a good dark chocolate. And we kind of had that conversation more, and then I had that conversation with Kamiguan as well. And you know what? It actually rings really true to me because my family, we're chocolate connoisseurs. Anytime we travel, we find that we shifted the time schedule to make sure that the days moved along the way we wanted it to, but it's still 4 days. It's 1 day per season. It is not a 25-hour season. It is a 24-hour season.
Okay, so it's going to be a 24-hour season.
Yes. So fantastic. That Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, you know, those 4 days are going to be each one season, and it'll loop around. The fact that there are 7 days in a week as opposed to eight means that we don't have to worry about it because every Monday will be a different season either way.
All right, fantastic. We're getting our responses back in chat now. They're saying, go on. So, okay.
All right, I guess we're going on.
Yeah, we're going on. All right, Hoxon asks, I think my biggest worry is the time scaling. Feels rushed. I would like to experience each season and day, but when they're whipping by at, you know, the light speed, I feel like I'm watching the world fast forward. And you know, it kind of does have a feeling of claustrophobia. I kind of get the feeling that he's talking about.
Yeah, so the seasons is the one that people tend to come down to, the fact that it's 1 day per season. There are many different systems that are at play there. There is combat and military. So for example, you march out to invade a neighboring county and you happen to time it such that it's winter and we have 4 days of winter and your entire troop is just out there in the snow for 4 days and there's nothing they can really do about it. They're moving extremely slow. They're cold. Their fatigue is dropping rapidly. It's just not a great experience. Likewise, for the farmers, you know, they want to plant and yeah, they can do things throughout the day that will allow them to continue their farming profession other than just planting and gathering. But the reality is that, you know, having 2 or 4 days between when they plant and when they harvest, it's going to be kind of boring for them. And then the other thing to note is that you guys will run out of food. So we could double the food, but there are other problems with that as well. Ultimately, we went with a system that feels like it's natural. And yes, one day it's spring, the next day it's summer, the next day it's fall and winter. But honestly, it doesn't feel like it's going to be that big of a deal. This is one of those that once players get in, we really want to see what their thoughts are. Until players are actually in the world and are seeing the seasons go by one day at a time, we don't plan on making any changes there.
I think perhaps the way I look at this is that I'm playing in summer and then it comes fall the next day, and then before I log out, I gotta think to myself, oh, I better make sure I have my furs on my inventory.
That's a good point. So Victoria has actually touched on that as well. There are different regions in the world, as you can imagine, longitude, latitude, and different latitudes have different temperatures. And the longitudes, depending upon whether or not you're living in a rain shadow or not, will determine how much water you get and what the temperature ranges are and that sort of thing. But in general, if you live in a region that is moderately temperature, you know, moderate around the equator, you're not going to see a huge variation in temperature each day. You'll see the seasons change and maybe the colors of the leaves change and that sort of thing, but it's not going to be more dramatic than that. If you live in an area that's, you know, snowy or becomes snowy, that's just going to be kind of one of those things you have to deal with living in an area like that. But it is something that we do here. It is something that we are paying attention to. We have talked about not going any further than 2 days, but making it so that the seasons span years. So you have a 6 month period of time where it's winter and a 6 month time where it's spring, et cetera, so that it does actually make it so that it's one season longer than, basically you don't see all four seasons in a single year. It would take 2 years to see all four seasons. It's something that we can do without actually affecting the gameplay mechanics too much, aside from the things I pointed out earlier. But again, until we get in and actually play it and find out how it feels with the 1 day per season and kind of what the variations are in temperature and stuff, depending upon where people reside, we're just not going to make changes until we get into game and see.
All right, fantastic. So basically, what you're kind of explaining is the regions will have biomes.
And there are like there are like 13 biomes. So yeah, there are different biomes, and many of the biomes aren't going to experience a huge range in temperature. You'll want to make sure that you either always have light clothes or always have, you know, a heavy cloak, but you're not going to see huge swings from one season to the next in most areas.
Got it. All right, that's a great answer to that question. Thank you. I think we got a bit more than we bargained for in that one. That's 13 biomes. That's impressive. Okay, moving on. World size. Sinian asks, they talk about a huge world, and it's always changing in some way, shape, or form, but will there really be enough to explore, or will most of the world just be open flat land with little things here and there?
No, it will not be mostly open flat land with little things here and there to explore. We don't have spawn points, and we don't have, you know, rogue camps and that sort of thing like that near towns. So what happens are things like NPCs in a town have a personality that might lead them to want to become criminals. They have they're extremely extroverted and have good leadership, so they're able to attract followers. And so they start migrating out of town one day, maybe every couple of hours, one of them leaves, and they set up a camp outside of town somewhere. Maybe it's a mile away, maybe it's 10 miles away, but they set up a base of operations there. And from there, they plan, a bigger storyline. And so what we're planning to do is we have the ability to keep track of where the majority of players go. So if they're mostly, they're hotspots, basically. We have a map of hotspots that says, okay, most people are congregating around here, and there's nobody really touching this area over here. It's been a long time since anybody's been there. And so that's a perfect place for us to set up a rogue encampment or take one of those dragons that we were talking about and having them put a nest in one of those nearby mountains that nobody's exploring anymore. And ultimately, make things happen there. So it's actually going to be those open lands that you're talking about where nobody goes, where the most interesting and exciting things are going to happen. So we really want people going out and exploring those frequently.
Okay, I think you answered that one pretty thoroughly. Fifth Guard's question is, my main concern with the game being so focused around player interaction is that my personal experience will then become limited purely because other players aren't actually around to interact with. And I've actually heard this from a lot of different people.
Mm-hmm. So he continues on talking about the gaming hours. So there's really two things about that. Number one, when we launch the servers, we're going to do so with a single continent. And we're going to populate, we don't have starting realms per se, there's no starting towns, but we do plan on exposing families that are kind of in common regions. So we want to fill up one region before we start populating another region. And in doing so, then we have fairly populated areas even from the beginning. And then by not having the whole world exposed at the beginning and forcing players to explore in order to grow out, we make sure that there's always kind of players around from a family standpoint. So there's always people around. As per normal gaming hours, that's something entirely different. The family system does allow you to ask for a family that's going to be playing around the same time of day as you, using time zones and other things. So that kind of helps you find a family that's going to be playing at the same time as you. And we also do plan to do regional servers. So we'll do North America server, we'll do some EU servers, we'll probably do an Australia server. And the reason that we can do that, and this is probably more than you guys need to know, but our servers are all hosted in the cloud. They're dynamic, they're designed to expand and contract based on load balancing needs. And so any regions that support our cloud infrastructure framework, we can actually host servers in that region. And that gives us the opportunity then to go up and show up in a couple different locales. So we're hoping that between having regional servers and the ability to pick families that are going to be playing at the same time as you, combined with the fact that the world will feel very small in the beginning and then grow from there, that it shouldn't be hard for you to find people to play on or play with, especially because we're trying to fit 100,000 players on a single server. So there you go.
So your answer then raised yet another concern for me.
Sure.
One of the things that you talk about in your design journals is this idea of bloodlines. And
yep.
Depending on what region your family is from, you have different bonuses to certain attributes. So say, for example, I personally am particularly interested in living in the desert because I like this idea of having a high endurance, high agility type player. Being a desert drifter is actually kind of exciting for me, especially as an explorer, combat type minded individual. At game launch, will I actually have access to join that kind of bloodline, or will I be locked to a region because that's where everybody's spawning out of?
No, so what will happen is we'll open up many of the different biomes, not all of them, but a lot of the main ones, so that people can create characters in those regions. But rather than having families across three different towns or three different villages in a single biome, we'll limit it to one region in a biome. So that way all the players are kind of showing up in the same village before expanding out to other villages. So that way we get the best of both worlds. There are opportunities for players to live in different regions, but when settling in that region, they all kind of settle in the same place initially.
Okay, cool. That answers my question. The next question is about our family system. It's the only question about our family system, and this comes from Prime. Another fear I have is not being able to comfortably play with friends. Say, me and a friend both join up, and I want the blacksmith, and he wants to be a champion, so we cannot even pick the same family, even if we could only one can inherit. Okay, you get the idea.
Just get that part, yeah.
Yep.
So I think this one actually was answered on the forum by a couple of community members. But the idea is that there's many different ways to play with someone. Families and being in the same family is not a prerequisite to playing with your friends. You could be neighbors. You know, you could live in different families in the same village. You could start in different villages and travel and group up together and become, you know, long best friends that party together. But even within the same family, you know, you can both choose to find a family that has one parent as a blacksmith and one as a champion, because certainly those could exist. Or you could just find a family that fits one of you and both join it as siblings with the understanding that, you know, one of you is going to really benefit from the parent's skills while the other one's not so much. But those are really only your starting skills. Keep in mind that your soul ramp contributes, a skill ramp from your soul contributes to a lot of what you're going to end up doing from a start. So if you pick a soul that was, let's say, a champion in a previous life, you're going to ramp up on those skills pretty quickly, regardless of whether or not your character starts with those. And so you shouldn't let the parents that are available really limit your story. You can still live the story that you want to. It just might be that you didn't start from a family of champions or blacksmiths, but you chose to go different from the family, to choose an occupation different than the family's occupation and strike out on your own. And that's a good story too.
I think, you know, this concern kind of does stem from the weight associated with family selection. I believe that the actual design journal called it a critical decision. And so, you know, would it be fair to say that somebody who starts in a family of champions would have an advantage over somebody who starts in a family of blacksmiths? Because really that's where this concern is stemming from.
Yeah, no, absolutely. The nearest chocolatier and or chocolate maker and make sure to partake. But we look at World of Warcraft as kind of like the Hershey's out there. You know, they came along, and you can even go back further. EverQuest and Ultima Online, I mean, they were you know, shipping raw cocoa powder to people, and the people back then, they loved it, but it wasn't refined, it wasn't processed, and it wasn't really as easy to consume. And then you have WoW comes along, and they're effectively the Hershey's, and they find this perfect recipe that, you know, people just love to consume. It's rich, it's creamy, it's easy to digest. Everybody loves it. They can consume it in bulk. And then there's been a slew of clones that have come along since then. You know, you've got your Mars and everybody else that's coming along and making effectively the same recipe with some slight variations in it. Well, Chronicles of Elyria we view as kind of like a really nice dark chocolate that's being developed by a small, you know, chocolatier. It's, you know, it's bean to bar. We're the developers and publishers. So, we're, you know, it's all natural. And we're developing, you know, some say a niche product. What we like to think of it as is we're developing kind of more of an artistic, we're developing something for a more mature palate. And so, you know, people who have been playing World of Warcraft, who've been eating that milk chocolate for the last 10 years, many of them are ready to move on to something else. And we want to be there for them, for when they, you know, take a look at it and realize that this is a different flavor. It's a more mature flavor. It's a little bit sharper. It's, you know, it's evolved. But at the same time, there are a lot of people who still don't like dark chocolate, even now that it's becoming, you know, more and more common. People are learning to appreciate that it's healthier and there's all these good benefits to dark chocolate. There are some people who still, because it's easy, it's cheap, it's, you know, it's accessible, they'll reach for the milk chocolate. So the reason I brought that up is that not only are we, in this case, a dark chocolate maker, a very specific, very refined chocolate, but we also add our own flavors to it. You know, we add the little sea salt caramel to the chocolate as well, and a little bit of mint here and there. And people who don't like those flavors aren't going to like the chocolate, no matter how good of a dark chocolate it is. It's just not the kind of flavor that they're looking for. And that's okay. And my answer to this, honestly, and I'll do the people over at Revival a solid and tell you guys that they're doing a game very similar to what we are in a lot of different ways. There are a lot of systems that are the exact opposite to what we're doing as well. But with that being said, I mean, their theme is a kind of a gothic, you know, it's a different world. It's a Lovecraftian kind of world. So if people, you know, they don't like the specific theme of the world we're going with, this is a sort of sword and sorcery style world with a touch of fantasy elements as well. If they want something different, then maybe there's just another game out there that's doing something similar to what we are that's better for them. You know, they have a different palette.
Real quick, because I love the analogy, but I think really at the heart of the question is, where on the low to high fantasy spectrum does Chronicles of Elyria fall?
It's somewhere in the middle. It's more on the high fantasy than people think. There are going to be fantastic creatures, so dragons are definitely a thing. For those who haven't seen me on Skype or whatever, my alias is Dragon Walsh. I had a period of time where I was just totally in love with dragons. I was sketching dragons, I was reading about dragons, I was researching dragon lore, I was reading dragon prints, and, you know, anything that had a dragon I was interested in. Dragons of Pern and the Caffrey, everything. So there is no way I'm not going to make this dream game of mine and not have dragons. At the same time, you know, we've already talked about vampires and stuff, so, you know, very likely undead will be a thing. Whether or not people encounter those regularly, we'll see. One thing I do want to call out is that these mystical creatures, these more fantastical things, because of where we sit in the low fantasy to high fantasy thing, those things are going to be less common. But when you encounter them, they're going to be that much more impressive as a result of that. You know, if you come upon a skeleton in your traditional D&D game, it's kind of like, oh, all right, well, it's a skeleton. Let's kill it and move on. You know, if you come upon a skeleton in a game like this, it's like, holy crap. There's undead. This is not good. We've never faced an undead before. We don't know what the effects are. Can you actually kill them, or are they going to keep coming at us? Like, you know, we want those types of things where people are just, they're overwhelmed by the fact that they're seeing these things for the first time. So you will see those higher fantasy elements, but it's not going to be on the surface and it's not going to be common.
All right, I'm going to move on to community. I feel that Zanz's question is pretty much Pazoki's question.
Okay.
So we're going to go ahead and move on. So the next one is from Sabby Cat. She says, my greatest worry is that after spending a great deal of time with community members and forming friendships with them, that once the game launches, it has something that causes them not to want to play, or they get bored and move on. So she's afraid she's going to lose her friends.
I think it's a he, between you and I. I think it's a he. But I put that, I read that off the list of concerns. I put that on there because I can sympathize. World of Warcraft has held on for so long, largely because it's the place where everybody goes to spend time with the friends that they've already established. You know, they reach that critical mass where there was a lot of people in the community. And so it feels like home, it feels safe. And we've started to build up this community now where people are meeting in IRC, they're on the forums all the time. You know, now they're starting to play games together. And I think that's fantastic. I really encourage that. I think that having a community is what more pigs are all about. You know, it's really about having a large community. And the more people that we can bring into that large community, the better that it will be. As a, you know, in response to us doing something that's going to cause people to not want to play, we sincerely hope that doesn't happen. And that's kind of one of the reasons why we're being as transparent as we are about this, is we want people to know the game that we're making from the very beginning so that they can decide whether it's something for them or not. And we also do want feedback from players. Mostly the game has been designed by me with some feedback here and there from some close friends of mine. And historically, I'm a software engineer. And while I've been a dungeon master and game master for a long time, some of these things we're going to have to play test in order to really get feedback on. And when that happens, you know, we will take the players' feedback seriously. With that said, and this was related to a conversation that we had recently on the forums, is that this is really our vision. It's our vision of what the dark chocolate should taste like. And because we get a large number of people who say, yeah, it's not really my flavor of dark chocolate, we're still going to be working on the recipe that we want to eat, not what the community wants to eat. But I encourage people, if you're concerned about it heading in a direction that you don't like, to make sure that you provide feedback. And beyond that, keep the community close, you know, and make it your community, make it your game, and make sure that more people join you. And other than that, I mean, I don't really have a lot of control on whether or not they decide to leave or not, but I certainly hope not. And we hope that by engaging you guys and letting you know that we're listening, myself and Sozu and Kamiguin and others, we got Persephone coming in tomorrow, a new hire. We hope that by engaging you guys and letting you know that we're listening, that it's not just the community and the developers, that we're all one community. And it just happens to be that the developers are a subset of the community, because we are really gamers that are making a game for gamers. And that includes you guys too.
All right. The next question is kind of going a different direction here about the community. And that is, there is one thing that worries me more and more these days, and that is the COE community itself. There's a couple different ways I feel like you can interpret that question, though. I mean, are we talking about in-game, out-of-game? How do people communicate with one another? I mean, to me, I feel like this question is more or less kind of about inside the game, because there's so many different ways that I feel like that you could be devious in this game than you could be in others.
I don't read that one about being in-game. I view that one as being out-of-game. And I think what the concern there is that, you know, we were 1,000 people in the community just 3 months ago, and now we're, you know, just on the border of 10,000 accounts in the community. And that naturally has an impact. Like the nature of the community is going to change as it gets larger. And I think what he's concerned about is that as people join the community, that the people who are there may not be as close, because it's more of a diluted community. And also that as we become more mainstream, as the community becomes larger, that it's going to bring in a different audience. It's going to be less the people who are really interested in the game and more just are kind of coming to check it out. They're more casual. Maybe they have negative feedback because they didn't spend the time digging into the forums to read out, you know, about what the game is really about. And so I think what he's just saying is that he's concerned that the mood of the community, or the, you know, the state of the community is shifting, maybe in a bad way. I've certainly noticed the impact of having a larger community, but I don't think it's necessarily a bad thing. I will say two things, then I'll move on. The first of which is that we intentionally didn't add search functionality to the forums. I know everybody that's listening to this now is silently throwing things at us. we keep getting feedback that we need to add search features to the forums, and we didn't. And we didn't do it intentionally. And the reason we didn't do it was because when we first launched the website, we knew there was only going to be 100, 200, 1,000 people. And what we were looking for from that 1,000 people was the group of people who were really passionate about the game, who we could look to be our GMs, we could look to be our moderators and our community managers, and the people who would go out there and sell the game to others for us. And so we made gathering information about the game difficult intentionally, because we wanted to pick out those people who were willing to put forth the effort to learn about the game. And so we've reached that point now. We know who they are. We've isolated, we've identified, and we're really pleased with the community, that I say the more dedicated community members that have come from that. And so now we're adding in the search functionality, and we've moved stuff over onto the wiki. And as the information becomes available to everyone and everybody kind of gets on the same page and they understand what the expectations is, then we expect the rest of the community to kind of fall in line with the community that's already there. But But yeah, that's I think why we're seeing that is that there was some frustration from the larger community that recently joined, and that frustration was designed to be there for a smaller community. But honestly, we've just grown faster than we expected to. So now we have to kind of change strategies.
All right, so now we're at a tipping point here, Caspian. We have 15 minutes left until the end of the hour, and we're nowhere close. So the
right.
question I have for you is, are you willing to go over, or should we skip to the questions that you're most interested in?
Well, I mean, I don't have a time frame, so this is that dangerous point where we can just make it a long stream and people can hear all about the cool stuff that we've got and the answers to these questions, or we can kind of cut it in two, or...
Well, I'll tell you what we can do, and we can ask them, but I already know their answer, and it's going to be go on. So if you have the time, I certainly have the time, so I just wanted to make sure, because I tried asking you one-sentence answer questions, and they turned into paragraphs. And books.
I'll be brief. I'll make an effort to move on more quickly. I will keep an eye on the watch now, and we'll move as quickly as we can.
Okay.
But let's drive onward.
Fantastic. Going on to Weathers and Seasons. Victoria Rachel asks, the developers have stated in the live chat that the seasons will be 25 hours long, and therefore the time seasons change is ever moving. I would personally like to see a 2.5 hour day remain, but not link the number of years or seasons to this figure.
Yeah, Victoria, I misread your question and I haven't had a chance to respond to it, and it keeps perpetuating.
Hello everyone, Bicycle Walrus here. Just wanted to let you guys know that this is actually only part one of this question and answer series. Basically, we only actually filmed part one today. We're going to be live streaming again tomorrow, Tuesday, at the exact same time, exact same place. We're going to finish up the rest of our questions with Jeromy Walsh then, and we can't wait to have you. And it's going to be an awful lot of fun, just like this question and answer session was. So without further ado, guys, enjoy the show. Thank you. Welcome to DM21 Gaming. My name is Bicycle Walrus, and today we are bringing to you a very special stream. Joining me today is Jeromy Walsh, otherwise known as Caspian, the technical director and CEO of Soulbound Studios. And wow, I'm so happy to have him. Caspian, sir, how are you?
I am doing very well. Thank you for having me on the show. This is a show, right? Do we call this a show or a stream?
We can call this a show.
Okay, let's go show. Well, thank you very much for having me on your show.
Oh, well, thank you for being here. It's quite an honor, and I know we have quite a... we got a ton of questions to go through, so I'm just going to hop right on into it, if that's all right with you.
That sounds good.
All right, fantastic. So, real quick, guys, to go ahead and provide some background here, we're going to be discussing a number of concerns and questions that people have about certain game mechanics that, you know, they maybe have a bit of worry about. This is more or less a constructive criticism type bit of questioning, as opposed to a, oh my gosh, you know, the sky is falling, we're concerned. We're obviously still very early in the development process of the game, and so that's kind of where we're at. So, the first couple of questions are about talents. And so Lankic says that, you know, I'm a very selfish person. And I worry that I won't get a talent. And Wyke also asks a bit of an associated question, which is, I want to be a magic user. I've paid my money, so make it so that I can be a magic user. Fix this now! How would you respond to that?
Those are good questions. They're very closely related, and it was something that I thought about before we did the first design journal. I had this question of whether or not I wanted to talk about magic at all from the very beginning, or whether or not I wanted to delay and wait until later. Ultimately, we went ahead and talked about talents early on because we felt like kind of showing our cards early and talking about the features of a soul was the right thing to do. But in retrospect, I kind of wish that we had left that out at that point and had really just approached this game as this is an MMO that's sword and sorcery style, but magic doesn't exist in this world. It hasn't been seen in thousands of years, and just kind of leave it at that. A lot of people have made a comparison to our game and some other like animes like Sword Art Online and Log Horizon. And, you know, in Sword Art, they've got this concept of sword arts, but there isn't actually magic in the world, at least not that's seen, and that doesn't happen until later in the show. And while there's really no connection between us and either of those shows, as I was watching that based on other people's recommendation, you know, it struck true. It's like, yeah, this is a combat-based world. It's a world of survival. It's a world where there are important things on the line, and magic doesn't really play a role in this. It doesn't really exist. And so that's kind of the message that we want to deliver with this world, is that if you see people doing magic, it should be feared, and it should be dealt with accordingly. And you're not going to see people wandering around doing magic. You're not going to have a mage in each of your parties. That's not going to be a big influence on the game. And so if I could, I would go back and I would actually reset history and say, listen, there's no magic in this game. And then when it happens and people see magic and it's, you know, something that's going on around them and it becomes part of the story, then everybody kind of wondering, well, what do we do now? Like, how do we deal with this? Is this a character mechanic? Is there some way for us to get this? Like, what do we do? And unfortunately, people kind of know in advance that's kind of going to happen. The best thing I can tell people at this point is it's going to be extremely rare, to the point where it's almost non-existent. And so we still hope that people won't feel like the fact that some small percentage of people out there can get it and everybody can't, other than that, is going to be a game changer for them. The other thing I can tell you, and this is kind of a foreshadowing, if you will, is that the magic and the existence of magic and kind of how prevalent it is a main part of the storyline. And I'm not saying that magic will ever become commonplace. That would certainly go against what we're trying to achieve in the world. What I can say is that we have intentionally withheld enough about the magic system so that you guys don't have a clear picture yet about how magic works, how common it is, or whether it's something you would even want if you could. So at this point, I'd say just don't worry about it. Wait until we are able to tell you a little bit more about how the magic system works, and you might find that that's less of an issue for you.
So essentially, what you're saying here is that, hey, you know, this is a world of combat, and magic is one of those really unknown things that people in this world don't even really know exists. So if everyone could all of a sudden say, I want to be a mage, which is what Wyke is saying, I've paid money, so let me be a magic user. Well, what you're saying is, your argument is, well, no one's a magic user, except all of a sudden, maybe one day, this happens, and we're kind of foreshadowing to that. But the way that you should look at it is, well, no one has magic, correct?
Yeah, I think the way I would respond to that question directly is you actually did pay money, but you paid money to be a champion, an explorer, a producer, a gatherer. You paid money for the experience and to be a part of the story. And if it turns out that your particular character has magic, that should be looked at as icing. It's not actually what you paid for. That comes separate.
Okay, fantastic. And this kind of leads into our next question, which is from Prime. And Prime says, I'm afraid that most people with talents or story souls will never know, so the 5% will look like 0%. And I'm actually going to add on to this question a little bit, too. It's 5% of souls, not 5% of players, correct?
It is 5% of souls, correct.
And so what that means is that when I buy the game, I get 3 souls. And so I might not even play all 3 of those souls. I might only play 1. And there will be some souls that people had played that could have had talents, but they didn't play them. Is that also a potential?
That is also a potential, yes.
All right, cool. Well, I'll let you respond to the question. I was just trying to elaborate a little bit more on top of it.
Sure. Let's see the best way to. So in case you guys can't tell, I just had time to get the list of questions kind of written down and transferred over to a document, which was then immediately handed off to Bicycle Walrus. So I haven't had a chance to read over most of these. So if you were concerned that I'd have these answers prepared ahead of time and it would somehow seem artificial, well, you can clearly see that's not the case. 5% look like 0. So this question was brought up once before, and we kind of addressed it on the forums previously, but I wanted to take this opportunity to go ahead and answer it as well. For us, the concept of talents are really there not as character-building tools, they're story-building tools. And that speaks to the previous conversation we had as well, which is people are thinking about the ability to have a talent as a character-building mechanic. It makes them stronger somehow. Oftentimes, the talents aren't going to make you stronger. It's going to make you a target. So it's not really something that you want. But with that said, we want these to be a tool for story building. And so One of the ways we've done this is just kind of randomly distributed these, because we know that eventually their use is going to play a role that will cause a story to happen. It's kind of the organic story. It's not contrived. It's just something that happens to some person. They're not prepared for it, and it leads to an interesting personal story for them. With that being said, we do have this concept of an overall, 10-year story. And for those scenarios, we will find places where we want there to be talents in play. It's imperative that a talent exists in order for the story to make sense in a specific role. And in those cases, whether or not the person had a talent otherwise or not, it's entirely likely that we'll take the person who's closest to the storyline, who's in the best situation in order to make that story come true, and we'll give them the talent that they need in order for that to happen. And so they'll never know, obviously, whether or not they had the talent to begin with and it just had never been unlocked prior to that, or whether or not it was kind of gifted to them as part of the story. Ultimately, it's the same. It means that out of nowhere, completely unexpected, they have an opportunity to play a kind of a dynamic character role in the story. They have the opportunity to steer it one way or the other, for good or for evil. And that the others around them who don't have those talents will have an opportunity to choose whether or not to follow them, to leverage the fact that they have those talents and support them, or to oppose them. And a lot of times it'll also depend upon the choice the person with the talent makes, whether or not they're supportive of the objective of everyone else, or if they're not. So if you have a talent and you decide to use it for evil, those of you around you who might be on the darker path, they might choose to flock to you and support you. Whereas those who are opposed to you because they follow the light, that are obviously going to make you enemy number one.
Okay, you touched on something that I have never heard of before, so I'm going to go ahead and reiterate it because, you're answering these questions very fast. You said that the Soulborn engine will kind of be smart enough that if there's a person or a player who's kind of getting ready to go down the path that might be associated with this magic use, the engine might say, well, hey, this person's best positioned to take advantage of the story arc, even though the soul did not actually have the talent at the beginning. He will now have the talent because he's actually progressing through that particular story. Is that correct?
That is correct.
So that actually, I think, eases a lot of concern in my mind, because me as a player, my thought is, well, how can I go out there and make the most of my subscription? How can I go out there and make the most of this life and do something that's interesting or different, or I'm exploring and I come across a particular story arc that all of a sudden takes me down that particular path or that road? It's something that players can actively seek and search for if they desperately want a talent, knowing that eventually it would be possible for one to be assigned to them, correct?
Yeah, that's a good way to look at it. I think the best way to answer that is to say that we want to reward people for being heroic. That was kind of our goal from the outset, is we want to reward people for creating story. And while we do seed the world with these talents as a way to kind of create unexpected story, those who pursue it, those who put themselves in the path of being legendary heroes, they're going to find that they're statistically more likely to encounter those types of talents. And it's not because we're actually trying to reward people directly. Like, if you go out and you kill a demon, that we will give you a talent. It's more like I'm going to go out and kill a demon because I feel like it's something that my character should do. And you get close to doing it, but you're going to fail on your own. And so the engine recognizes that you're playing a pivotal role. You're a catalyst for a